tell you, you're better off in the sun than in the shade.
This is football weather, John.
There's head coach Kroom doing a terrific job in Starksville. His fourth season as the head coach. Of course, he has a lot of pro experience, too, as an assistant coach for several different pro teams before taking over the Bulldogs. And, of course, Rich Rodriguez, the success story just continues for him. This is his seventh season. He, in his career, now has won 100 games, taking his team to four straight January 1st bowl games, and that speaks highly of the job he's done with the Mountaineers.
76 winning percentage in the last 4 years.
They kind of hid the toss of the coin from us.
What's your prediction?
And I think that West Virginia is going to be receiving the opening kickoff. I tell you the truth, I'm not sure whether the Bulldogs won and deferred to the second half or what. We couldn't see them. They were on the other side of the band. They were hiding from it.
We'll all find out together, John.
Absolutely. Well, plenty of gold in the stands, and this is Gold Day. The alumni are back. We'll have the alumni cheerleaders. We'll have the alumni band. They are here to celebrate and see if their team can go 6-1. And the importance there is they get set to kick off, and that's Adam Carlson, is that they've got to stay right in this bowl chase because some of the BCS teams continue to tumble, don't they?
Yeah, they really do, and it's interesting. Week in and week out, you don't know where you're going to wind up, and West Virginia still has an excellent opportunity to wind up in the BCS championship in the Superdome.
Well, we could say the same thing about 10 or 15 teams the way it's going, you know?
But they have the weapons, the capabilities, offense and defense to be there.
Slayton is out on the kick return team, along with Jock Sanders. So they shake it up just a little bit. And, of course, Vaughn Rivers, who does a lot of the kick returns, especially on the punts, he is deep as well. Kind of a reduced role in the punt returns and kick returns for Raynaud of late. We will see a lot of Rivers, and we're seeing Sanders out there, and also number 10, Slayton. Important, I think, for this very first possession, especially if you're the Bulldogs, Renee, you've got to do something right away. Kick is going to be taken at the 10-yard line. And the ball comes loose inside the 20. Let's see. And it's going to be Mississippi State ball as the Mountaineers turn it over on the opening kick of the day. So a break immediately in great field position near the 20-yard line for Mississippi State. Let's see what happened on this kick return. Slayton was the man who received it. Took it at the 10 and never really had control of it.
And he kicked it towards Mississippi State oncoming. The pursuit just got up with it. Too many white jerseys coming that way and just outnumbered West Virginia. Good, great opportunity for the Bulldogs.
Anthony Johnson fell on it. So the Bulldogs will get a quick opportunity.
They'll re-kick it now.
Oh, well, obviously there was something wrong with there that we didn't see. Did he make a call?
Yes, we didn't see that.
Offside was the call. Well, that's a break for the Mountaineers, because you're right, Slayton never really had control of the ball.
No, he really didn't. It went right through his arms, and Sylvester Kroom is beside himself right now with a great opportunity for the Bulldogs to jump on top with some kind of scoring opportunity, and now it goes awry with the re-kick.
Well, let's see if Steve Slayton can do a little better job if he handles this one. Out there with Rivers, Jock Sanders. And he's trying to get his team to move up because they're going to be penalized 5 yards. So you've got to come 5 yards closer, right?
That's where the whole problem started. I guess everyone is not attuned to the rules. They've changed, but maybe we're still practicing from 2004 and 5.
Adam Carlson again will handle the kickoff, but this time it'll come from back at the 25-yard line. So the Mountaineers, assuming they can hang on to the football, a lot of these players, Renee, are from the state of Mississippi. Some of them went to junior college. In fact, a whole handful of them with the various junior colleges that still made their way back to Starkville. Let's do it again. Same man, Slayton, same spot, 10-yard line. This time he catches it, 30. Spun down as he gets across the 35-yard line. Defensively, Marcus Washington down there for the Bulldogs. A 25-yard kickoff return as we are underway, and there is Patrick White. Apparently healthy, apparently ready to go. There was some question. You see his season completion percentage is outstanding, and his rushing is not even listed there. So he is a terrific player on the offensive side of the ball. And we'll see how the tempo is. Schmidt is playing fullback in this formation as they are out of the shotgun. And you'll see Schmidt all over the place as well. He'll be a tight end. He'll be in the slot. He had a quick kick a couple weeks ago. First possession comes from about the 35-yard line. And it's White all alone at midfield. Cuts it back. He's got a chance. 30, 20, 15. Touchdown, Patrick White. 64 yards for White.
He fooled everybody, Renee. There was nobody close to him.
That was great ball handling, and he sold the entire defense that Slayton had the ball. That is his eighth rushing touchdown of the season, and he did a great job and then just put on the afterburners and ran away from the competition. You can see why this is so dangerous. Just a fake dive. Everyone sucks into that, and he is all alone, and it's a mismatch when Patrick White is one-on-one with anyone. This is a mismatch. As no one is going to catch him from behind as Derek Pegues tries to catch him. You won't catch a 4-4-1 speed.
What a turnaround for the Bulldogs of Mississippi State. Looked like they had the opening kickoff on a turnover at the 20-yard line. Instead, they get the return out to the 34 and race it down the field. 64 yards for a touchdown, and just like that, the Mountaineers have shocked the Bulldogs. They take a 7-0 lead on homecoming.
Own a time. You know us. We're Brick Street Insurance, and we're a West Virginia company. And now we're combining powerful resources for your business with teams of experts delivering comprehensive services from risk management and underwriting to claims and return to work programs. Introducing Brick Street 360, an innovative approach to workers' compensation insurance.
Brick Street 360, in-state, on-site, and all around your business.
It's the Chevy Summer Sales Drive, where you'll find the all-new Chevy Silverado 1LT with the best available 4x4 highway fuel economy and the best warranty of any full-size pickup. Better than Ford, better than Toyota. And now we're giving Silverado our best lease yet.
Qualified lessees can get a low-mileage lease on this 07 Silverado half-ton for around $259 a month. Residency restrictions apply. Call for details.
Chevy, West Virginia's best-selling brand for the last 6 years.
Lucky Dog, I sure am a lucky dog, because I live at the destination for savings, selection, and service, Joe Romeo's I-79 Honda.
07 Odyssey, 2.9% for 36 months, 4.9% for 60 months. 07 Element, 2.9% for 36 months, or 4.9% for 60
lucky
months.
Lucky Dog, great cars, big savings, and a hot girlfriend, too. Now you're one hot dog.
Mac, you sly dog, you always have a silver tongue.
Joe Romeo's I-79 Honda.
Your Yellow Pages connection, easy to use. Big book, it's affordable, and people use it. Easy to use. Big book, local people, local sales. It comes to you in the mail. Your Yellow Pages connection, easy to use. Big book.
Well, after a fumble that wasn't a fumble because of a penalty, 21 seconds gone in the game, and Patrick White, apparently, Renee, he's healthy. Looked pretty good on that one.
That was one of his better runs since he's been here in Morgantown, and what an exciting way to start a game.
Well, he had over 85 yards against the Bulldogs last year. His running mate, Slayton, had 185. There's Pegues, who will be one of the deep players to receive. Pegues is the deepest man. He's standing at the five, the kicking handled by Pat McAfee. Pat does the kickoffs, he does the punting, he cleans up the locker room after the game. And Pegues will move up to about the 11-yard line. Some room up the middle across the 30. And finally squeezed down and swarmed under as he gets to the 33-yard line. A 22-yard return on the play. And the Bulldogs will have their first offensive possession. Let's take a look at a true freshman quarterback starting for them. Wesley Carroll, this is just his fourth collegiate start. Last week in that loss to Tennessee at home, he threw his first collegiate touchdown passes, a couple of them. Where's number 13? He is a true freshman. This is his fourth start.
74 attempts without an interception, John. Interesting.
That is impressive for a true freshman. Two wideouts come to the left side. That's Dixon and Hoskins are the running back. Hoskins is the fullback. He rarely, if ever, carries the ball. This is Dixon, right side, tries to get outside and does a little bit, steps it back in across the 35 to near the 37. Mark Magro, one of those outstanding West Virginia linebackers, is there to make the tackle. Let's take a look at the backs and the receivers for Mississippi State. And Eric Hoskins, that fullback, as I mentioned, is strictly strictly a blocking back. Does not carry the ball very much. There you can take a look at that offensive line. They're led in the middle by their center, who is on the watch list. That's Blackledge on the Remington watch list, is the outstanding center. Picked up about five on the play. Second down. Receiver comes in motion near side. Straight drop, looking left, throwing and deflected in. Incomplete. Larry Williams was there, number three, and let's take a look at the rest of that West Virginia defense as Williams almost made the interception of the deflected pass. There are the down linemen, a lot of them from Florida on this team. Dingle has five sacks. The linebackers make most of the tackles for West Virginia. Magro just made one right there. And in the secondary, Malik getting his third career start. He started the first two games of the season and has not started, and he's back in there in that secondary starting this afternoon. Third down and still five out of the shotgun. Again, Carroll looks one way. The ball is knocked in the air and incomplete. Lewis was there, and that's the kind of coverage that you need if you're West Virginia. Johnny Dingle, the guy we just talked about, was right in his face, and that's one of the big improvements, is that defensive line.
And the thing about this 3-3-5 defense, they can bring pressure from everywhere. You know, last year they had to bring the safeties a lot. And look at this pressure. They had five men, and you just can't block that many, usually four or five.
And it is Blake McAdams to punt. Rivers at his 15-yard line gets away from one defender. And across the 20 out to about the 24-yard line. Making the tackle on the special teams was Aaron Feld. 47-yard kick, 7-yard return. West Virginia will have it for the second time when we come back to Morgantown with more college football on a Saturday. And we do have a flag. Thank you. So let's wait.
Personal foul, number six, receiving team. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
So that foul is on Lewis. It came after the play, and it's going to give the Mountaineers very poor field position. It was a 7-yard return of a good kick, 47-yard punt on that play. But the penalty is going to set them back. So the Mountaineers, who started their first possession from the 36-yard line, are not going to be quite as fortunate this time out. This one's going to go back to the 12-yard line. A quick look at Mike Dent, the center. Ryan Stanchik is probably the best of those offensive linemen. Rich Rodriguez right there. He'll tell you his team is not as big as some of these teams, but they have to use their speed, and that, of course, is a key. Schmidt is playing a tight end in this set. Slayton is the lone setback behind Patrick White. There's Slayton up the middle. He'll get one or two, and that's about it. Let's check the rest of that Mountaineer offense that's out there. In the first time ever in those gold tops and blue pants, and there are the wide receivers. We've talked a little bit about Owen Schmidt. We listed Villagrana at tight end, but a lot of times, like on that last play, it's Owen Schmidt. He's all over the place. And there are the offensive linemen. Stanchik is at that left side. Selvish Capers making the start at right tackle. That is a change for West Virginia. Schmidt goes back to the fullback spot. They split the backs, go out of the shotgun, two wide receivers to the near side. Inside handoff. 25. Fighting close to a first down. I think he's going to get to the 21-yard line. Bowman made the tackle defensively for the Bulldogs. This is a team that last year was just giving up about 100 yards a game on the ground and got burned for 311 by West Virginia. There are those defensive linemen for them, all over 300 pounds except for Hannibal. The linebackers, Jamal Chaney is the leading tackler out of Fort Pierce, Mississippi. And in the secondary, Pegues has a couple of interceptions. He is also the kick return man, so we'll see a lot of number three on defense and on special teams today. Third and one, quick pass, flat is caught by Slayton. Slayton out to the 35-yard line, first down. Tackle made by Pegues. A 14-yard pickup.
A little cushion from the quarterbacks allows his play to work as Patrick White makes it look like he's going to run the ball. Little good check from the wide receiver, good block, allows Slayton some running room. Nice play, and really, again, Patrick White sold the defense on the fact that he was going to run the ball and froze the defense for a second, froze the linebacker.
Schmidt now moves out as a wide receiver in this set. Just one setback. It's first and 10, ball at the 34-yard line. And again, this time, that was the same play they started the game with, except this time they handed it to Slayton. And White took off the other way and was all alone. Brown made the tackle for Mississippi State. Not much there. And Slayton's numbers, Renee, have fallen off a little bit in the last few games.
Yeah, he needed that week's rest, John, last week, the off week, and I think is going to help him a lot. But, you know, he gets a lot of his, does a lot of his damage in the second half. 55% of his yardage comes in the second half, so he gets better as the game goes on.
Looks for Slayton. Little room at the 30. 35. One man to beat, and he will not beat him. Coming up to make the play was Damon Glanton. And that was a pretty good tackle right there because it looked like Steve Slayton was trying to set him up and break something big time. Couldn't get away with it.
Patrick White delivers the ball, and he's got a little cushion. Slayton does in front of him. As you see, an entourage blocking downfield. Good blocking allows him to get close to the first down, a pick of about 7 yards, and third down and three.
Brandon Hogan in there as a wide receiver. Now we're going to see about 6 to 8 guys playing wide receiver in this spread offense for West Virginia. It is third down. Schmidt and Slayton are split. They're the running backs. Two wide receivers near side, one far side. White looks, throws, got it at midfield. Pass is caught by Tito Gonzalez, a junior from Tampa, Florida. We're going to say the state of Florida a lot this afternoon. They have a lot of kids from Florida.
They have a lot of people from Florida. You know, this is a nice slant pattern. Throws it right between defensive players, and Tito makes catch number 5 on the season, and he's a big one, 6'2", 210, just a junior. But he's a super blocker with 25 knockdowns.
Strong side right, and the tight end this time is Owen Schmidt. Two wide receivers left. There's the fake of the handoff. White trying to get outside, and he'll slide forward to about the 38. Pegues comes up to make the tackle. What are your keys for the Mountaineers today, Renee?
Well, they have to create turnovers, confuse that young quarterback, good penetration, and don't let Dixon get started. Number 2 is control the tempo with that no huddle, proper reads, and execute. They've done a pretty good job thus far.
Second down coming up. Didn't get quite as far. His knee went down just outside the, or just inside the 45-yard line. So it's second down. And whistles. Yep. We'll check it out.
Dead ball foul. False start. Number 88. Offense was not to the line of scrimmage. Put his hand down in a 3-point stance and picked it up. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
That's Villagrana, the tight end from Boardman, Ohio, who was called for the penalty. And he's going to come off.
John, you may see Pat White run from that pistol formation. He's only 3 or 4 yards back as opposed to the shotgun. The advantage of that is when he runs from the pistol formation, you have the tailbacks on either side of you. It's easy to hand off. You're close to the line. You can do more damage sometimes. And you see Patrick White more from the pistol than the shotgun at times.
Mark Carlos is our referee this afternoon. It is second down and 10 now for West Virginia. Out of the shotgun. There's a quarterback draw. White's got some room. At the 40, gets outside, gets a lead block, and is down at the 25-yard line. Glanton finally ran him out of bounds. But that was Owen Schmidt helping him finish off a 24-yard run.
And what a great run. He's improvising here and just reading with his eyes and reading as he goes. But an outstanding block, John, as you just said. Owen Schmidt, number
35,
right there, allows him to get some more cushion, get downfield. And Owen Schmidt is a guy who's a cult hero. He's already broken 9 face masks thus far.
And it is Slayton down inside the 20, spinning his way inside the 15-yard line. So Slayton fighting, slashing, spinning. Avery Hannibal finally made the tackle. Steve Layton picks up another first down for Morgantown. The West Virginia Mountaineers on the move again.
Steve Slayton has gained a little weight. He's about 200 pounds now. He already has 3 200-yard gains to his credit, and he's well on his way to another outstanding performance. He looks very, very good.
Schmidt and Slayton are the running backs. It is first and 10. The ball is just nosed inside the 15-yard line. Let's call it the 14. Inside handoff, Slayton. Not that time. Wrapped up before he gets to the 10-yard line. He'll pick up a couple. Dominic Douglas, number 10, was there defensively, and that time they couldn't spring him. You know, at one point, and that's probably during this 2 weeks they've had off, basically, Rich Rodriguez got after his offensive line a little bit. He said, you guys, you have to do a better job of letting Slayton and White get downfield, get turned up, and get some positive yardage.
And they need to get more physical, John. You know, they kind of run the same type of blocking up front as the Denver Broncos, that zone stretch, and they need to get a little more physical.
This is the 12th play on this drive. It's second down and eight. He got two on that possession. Inside. And Slayton, again fighting, and he's going to be stopped short of the 10. He'll get about one. Swamped under, Chaney, Jamar Chaney, their leading tackler with 50 coming in, was leading the way there, number 22. Chaney originally signed with Georgia. He's out of Pierce, Florida, and then wound up here at Mississippi State.
Well, he's a guy with a lot of speed, 4.56 speed, and he had 11 stops against UAB, but that play was going nowhere. Patrick White and Slayton collided on the handoff.
Oh, White so far. 33 yards passing and 93 yards rushing, so he is doing his part. Fakes the handoff. He's got Schmidt wide open at the 10. At the 5. Dives for the end zone. Just short. No, it went in. Bobo tripped him up. But the guy that loved to break helmets went for it right there. Schmidt gets another touchdown. That is his third touchdown rushing of the season.
And that was a nice little catch and run. And, you know, for a 6'3", 260-pounder, he negotiates under 4'6", 4". And, boy, he is a load coming right at you when he's running downhill. He is an All-American, strength All-American.
McAfee for the extra point. Trying to make it 14-0. And we are just almost midway through the first quarter. McAfee is good on the extra point. But this Mountaineer offense, see how wide open Schmidt is? White finds him, but from the 4, diving, he gets across for the touchdown. Well, it took him 5 minutes and 20 seconds longer to score touchdown number 2 than it did touchdown number 1. So you can't be any more wide open than Owen Schmidt was right there. Gets away from the first tackler on the play, and then takes it in by himself, leaping over to get the score. And the referee finally signaled it. 88 yards, 12 plays, 5:41 on the clock. Remember, their first drive took 21 seconds, so it's 14-0. Pegues is back deep to receive the kick to Pat McAfee. Kind of start, Renee, as Pegues will backpedal a yard deep into his end zone and start to come out. The kind of start to the game the homecoming crowd wanted to see, but they're going to have to check down Pegues as he's out to midfield. Great return. Holmes made the tackle on the special teams, but Pegues goes 57 yards on the play and gets inside the 50-yard line. Let's take a look at the keys now for the Bulldogs.
Keys for the Bulldogs. Control the clock, run the ball with heavy doses of Dixon. Recognize formations, play discipline. Remember, Mississippi State doesn't see that. No SEC runs this spread option. Stay with their keys and keep Slate and White inside if possible. To do.
It has been so far for them. Dixon is the lone running back behind freshman quarterback out of Parkland, Florida. Wesley Carroll last week started against Tennessee. Here's Dixon. Lost the ball. Who's going to get it? West Virginia has it. Picked out of the air by Magro. And Magro still on his feet at the 30. From behind, he's wrapped up inside the 20. Brandon McCray finally tracked him down, but Magro, that ball just popped in the air and landed right in his hands.
Good things happen if you hang around the ball, and Magro is always around the ball. Dixon is really hit. They're going to what we thought they would do, give it to Dixon on a stretch, and he has popped real hard right here from the back. Looks like Keelan Dykes may have popped that ball loose, and Magro looks like he knows what to do when he's got that ball. Breaks a tackle there, and McRae has to catch him from behind. I tell you, it looks like he's running out of gas there, John.
You're right. Those linebackers aren't used to seeing that much green, you know, when they get the ball. Magro, a hometown boy. He is from Morgantown, West Virginia. Schmidt, Slayton, the running backs. White out of the shotgun. Two wide receivers, far side, one near side. Golden chance for West Virginia. Address lead. Slayton cuts it back, and he's knifed down as he gets Wait inside the 15. Avery Hannibal made the tackle. Slayton picked up short yardage. West Virginia has scored each of the two times they have had the football. Will Johnson now checks in, and you can see that Raynaud Hogan, Jala, Lyons, Johnson, Sanders, Sowers, Gonzalez. I mean, they've got a roster of wide receivers in this offense.
And they're like cookie cutters. They all do the same thing exceptionally well. Good receivers and great blockers. You have to be a good blocker in this offense.
You do, because that's how you spring your guys downfield. Inside handoff to Schmidt. He falls inside the 10 to about the 9 on the play. Tripped up by DeMond Blanton, number 8 defensively. It was Blanton who was involved in that last play and then could not make the tackle.
You know, John, they run the zone blocking, and the inside zone is basically a vertical step, and then up the field. Your next step is right to the crotch of your defensive player, and they need to get a little more physical with that inside zone running.
They're down at about 3. They need to get down to 7 for a first down. Fight, look, Strohs, taking in zone touchdown. Darius Renaud, an outstanding athlete in his own right, a senior from Louisiana. Renaud into the end zone for the touchdown. That is his 7th of the year.
And once again, Patrick White just sells that with the play action fake right here. He's booting left and finding Renaud, which is all alone. Safety can't get over quick enough. You have to respect that run. Remember, they run 68% of their plays are running plays, 32% passing. So you got to play run first, and he'll burn you as he just did. 2nd touchdown toss of the game, John.
Still 6 minutes to play in the opening quarter, and the extra point is up and good again. 21-0. Now, this is a switch from last year in Starkville when they scored 21 points in the 4th quarter to put that one away. They have scored 21 so far here in the 1st quarter in Morgantown. Happy homecoming so far with 6:09 to play in the 1st quarter, 21-0. Along with Renee Nadeau, I'm John Sanders. There's Derek Renaud, who just scored a touchdown. The total yardage at this point in the game for West Virginia, 173. For Mississippi State, 9.
Whoa, that's why you can see the score 21-0 with 6:09 to go. Rich Rodriguez, he's got that game face on. He looks like he's behind by 21.
This is going to be a short kick. It's going to bounce, and it's going to be fielded at the 20-yard line. Bringing it back that time is Anero Stallworth, who comes from the same hometown as Patrick White. Both from Alabama.
Anthony Alabama, high school teammate of Patrick White, is more of a receiver than a running back, but I'm sure they exchanged some acquaintances before the game.
Now, where is Daphne, Alabama?
Middleport of Alabama, right outside of Mobile.
Okay. Yeah, 3 plays, 16 yards. The turnover set him up. Minute 13 to go. The turnover in the 35-yard return by Magro. Dixon is the lone setback. You've got the tight end, Sherrod. And 2 wide receivers. Dixon, some room up the middle. He's dragged down as he gets across the 30 to the 32 by Reed Williams. And Reed Williams, the junior from Moorefield, West Virginia, is the leading tackler on this team.
8 stops a game, 7th in the Big East. They had a 5-man front facing him, and you can see good ground level shot right here. Power in those legs. And going to make a stop like that, slow him down. You're pulling down a 6'1", 240-pound running back with a good head of steam running downfield.
Well, he did get a little initial burst, picked up 6 yards on the play. Bell and Burks are the wideouts to this side. They've got the fullback Hoskins in there. That motion man is Burks. This is Dixon. Dancing close to the 35. He'll be about a yard and a half short of the first down. Wrapped up in there by that Morgantown, West Virginia defense. This guy will do the work. He will be a load. He had some outstanding runs last week against Tennessee, and he's averaging just under 100 yards a game.
He had 103 against Auburn, 108 against Tennessee. He keeps the play alive. John has got great individual effort, yards after contact. The first hit is not going to take him down.
Chris Neld in there defensively on that last play, number 90 for West Virginia. They try to load up that box against Dixon. Once again, the motion man is Burks. The freshman quarterback is wrapped up at the 25 by Kellen Dykes. Keelan Dykes tracked him down in the backfield, drops him at the 25. And that was one of your keys for the young quarterback that's got to be able to handle the pressure that he's going to get from West Virginia.
And he just came through the B gap, and that was a tough thing to do because the split was so tight from Mississippi State offensive line. And Keelan Dyke just came. He looked like he was almost unblocked, but another tackle for a loss, and boy, he's a big ringleader. Kate thought of coming out to the NFL in 2006.
Blake McAdams kicked one 47 yards, his first time. Vaughn Rivers deep for West Virginia. This kick is not as good unless he gets a good roll. And it's way out of bounds. Let's see where they mark it. As we've got a Mountaineer and a Bulldog hooked up at the 35-yard line. And they're going to mark it inside Mississippi State territory at the 48-yard line. Just a 23-yard kick. And I tell you what, the head coach, Krum, will tell you, you can't give them that kind of field position on a consistent basis.
Not special teams. That will kill you because Patrick White will burn you with an opportunity shrinking the field like that.
Ball's going to be at the 48-yard line. It'll be the fourth possession of the opening half for West Virginia, and they've scored three touchdowns.
And they run this jet tempo. You know, you have three tempos, regular tempo, Indy tempo, and the jet tempo where there's no huddle, nothing. Just go in between plays, and he's running fast now.
Schmidt is at the tight end spot this time. Slayton is the lone running back. Three wide outs in the formation. I want to ask you about Schmidt when I get a chance. As Slayton is grabbed from behind and dropped on the play. Tripped up after a gain of just a couple. How do you move around to so many different spots as Schmidt does? One time he's in the backfield. He could be a wide receiver. That time he was lined up as a true tight end.
Well, NFL scouts love this guy. You know, you see dollar signs. If you were Owen Schmidt, you'd be looking at dollar signs because he can play so many positions. He'll certainly be probably a third or fourth round pick. They'll find a spot for him, but great special teams, and as you said, John, can catch the ball, block, and run.
Yeah, he went to a small college up north, and then that one is thrown short and incomplete, and it is called a pass. It was intended for Raynaud. Excuse me, intended for Brandon Hogan. Number 22, not number 2.
23. That's for O'Quinn, depending on the play.
And they got pressure that time, and you can see quickly in the backfield was Jesse Bowman, and he kind of disrupted that play. Shot through the A gap before Patrick White could set his feet and throw the ball, and kind of that was more of a throwaway than anything.
Yeah, it was his first incompletion. He's now 5 for 6, and he has been dynamite, both running and passing the football. He's been the dominant figure so far this afternoon. And there's a little screen set up for Slayton. He gets away and steps out of bounds. He was forced out of bounds by Hughes, and Douglas was there as well. Just got enough of him to push him out of bounds. He's going to be, I think, a little short of the first down.
Pressure came from the inside, and that was Tim Bailey, but Patrick White got rid of the ball quickly, and Slate broke a tackle, got up the field. Not enough for a first down. It's going to be fourth and short.
And they're going to keep the offense on the field. They have been terrific on third and fourth downs. They're going to continue the play. It's thrown away. Intended for Hogan. Right there defensively was Pegues. And it looked like a late hit on White, who was very slow getting up.
That was Titus Brown, a left defensive end, the all SEC type guy.
Offsides, number 54, defense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Well, that's another gift from the Bulldogs right there.
And that's something you don't see very often. He's a senior, and he's been around. Titus Brown has been around a while, and that's just frustration, I think. And, you know, he buried Patrick White.
Yes, he did, and that's in that chest area where he's been bothered the last couple of weeks since he took that hard hit in the Syracuse game. He was also injured earlier this year, but if they have to go to Jared Brown, they don't fall off too far, do they?
No, that's Vince Young, the next second coming of Vince Young.
So it's first down at the 35. Schmidt moves out to a wide receiver slot. He's in this in wide receiver spot. He's in the slot on the right side. You see White changing the play a little bit. Moves Slayton from one side to the other. It's first and 10, 35 of Mississippi State. Just over 3 minutes to play. Slayton spins. Still spins again down to the 25. Hughes made the tackle for Mississippi State, but very elusive that time. And that's not that open field running we're used to seeing. That's hard work running right
yeah,
there.
And what he's doing more so now than before is coming right at you, or really a good shot here, is he is attacking the defense. He broke one, two, three tackles. He's carrying a couple of defenders with him, but he's gained about 10 pounds. He's around 200 pounds now, and he runs downhill much, much better. Once he gets past the line of scrimmage, has a good head of steam.
Schmidt back in the true fullback position in front of Slayton. Slayton has it. He's got some room. Open up the middle. 10, cuts it back. 5, touchdown. That's the record. 26 yards for the score. And a record for him in career touchdowns. He is the current active leader in the country. So it's 28-0, West Virginia. And if you're Mississippi State, you've got to be dazed right now.
Well, you know, running is their bread and butter, and now you have to deviate a little bit. As you can see, Slayton, this is just outstanding running with his vision, breaking a tackle right there and picking up, just setting up his blocks and cutting against the grain. Just great vision. And, you know, the best backs, this is what they do. Great. He's making his cuts at full speed, John, and that's the mark of an outstanding back.
Well, O'Quinn was the last to have a look at him, and when you were 5 yards away from him with 10 yards left to go to a touchdown, you have no chance.
You know, it's tough to catch him in a phone booth, you know, much less in the open field like this. And, you know, when he's running full speed and has that 4.36 speed, not anyone is going to catch him in the open field.
Well, I'll tell you what do you do now if you're Coach Kroom?
Well, you know, believe it or not, they've hurt themselves with fumbles and penalties and things
yes.
like that. So really, this game, it looks a lot worse than it really should be. If they had the ball on the opening kickoff with the fumble, it might have been a different game. They fumble a ball over on a possession, Tony Dixon. So they have to get back to the basics. And they can't get away from their running game. They are passing attack. You can't put all the pressure on Wesley Carroll, a true freshman.
Pegues back to return. He had a nice return of the kick his last time up, 57 yards. But as you said, what immediately followed that was that fumble that wound up in the hands of Magro. He returned it 35 yards to set up another touchdown. And then on the fourth down play, they had the penalty.
It's just penalties that really killed the Bulldogs.
Again, it's the short man who's going to take it right there. Stallworth with his second kickoff return as they are staying away from Pegues. So another march for a touchdown by the men from Morgantown, 48 yards in a minute, 37 seconds, 5 plays. Slayton scoring from 26 yards out, his 43rd rushing touchdown. A record for West Virginia. And this week off must have helped this offense.
Wow, they are really rested. It looked like it's the opening game of the season. Fully charged.
Smith and Burks are the wideouts. Dixon is the lone setback behind the freshman quarterback Wesley Carroll. This is Dixon. Gets away from one tackler and is straightened up. And that's that power we talked about, as he was able to push Ryan Mundy back to about within about a yard of a first down. Interesting for Wesley Carroll last week when he played Tennessee at home. Both of his folks graduated from Tennessee.
That's interesting, you know, and he's from, as you mentioned, Eastern Park in Florida, but he had a chance to go to either North Carolina State, Duke, or Central Florida. Very cerebral guy, good football IQ.
Well, an eye formation of Hoskins, the fullback who never carries the football, in front of Anthony Dixon, second and short. Bulldogs trying to sustain some kind of an offensive drive. That's Burris in motion. No place to go. The ball is picked up by Ivy. And he's going to strip to the end zone. The flag goes down. 45 yards on the return. But after another fumble, there was a flag down. And I figure that's going to be a block in the back or a clip. We'll see. In any case, I think this touchdown is coming back. You see
wow.
The umpire talking to the referee. The return of 45 yards.
After the change of possession, illegal block in the back. The intercepting team. 10-yard penalty, first down.
You know, the thing about this penalty for West Virginia, it was well behind the play.
Yes.
He was already past the 20-yard line.
And Ivy, that had been his first touchdown. So he's going to find who did this. because it was just a poor exchange. The ball bounces out. You can see Ivy right there in his linebacker position. And Dixon trying to make a futile attempt there, but just couldn't
get to
it.
There's the block in the back. You saw it right there. And he was already past that defender. That was Vaughn Rivers who was called for the penalty. We'll see if it slows the Mountaineers down at all. So they'll wipe out that touchdown. It's still 28-0. We're in the final minute and a half of the opening quarter. Slayton, Schmidt, the running backs. Villagrana is in at tight end. There's the inside handoff. And again, spinning for about 5 yards. Let's talk about Slayton a little bit. Bailey made the tackle on that play.
You know, and he can catch the ball, which he does right here. Good juke move to the outside. He can run with the ball. As you see, inside running, breaking tackles and spinning. Outstanding balance. And he can run away from it, as he has right here. As you see him running to the end zone, setting the record. So he can do the, he's the total package.
It is second down and about six out of the I formation. The Mountaineers have had great field position. Raynaud on the reverse. Tries to cut it back, but cannot get away at the 25-yard line. That was Pegues who stayed with him, and it looked like Raynaud would do something. The last three drives for West Virginia have started at the Mississippi State 17, 48, and 30.
Yeah, and you can't shrink the field for an offense such as this with the weapons they have. And, you know, you can see Raynaud, but Pegues does a great job in the free safety position. He is outside responsibility, and you don't play it any better than this. Tackle Raynaud in the open field by yourself.
It's third down and about six. Again, out of the gun with Schmidt and Slayton. Wide out left, wide out near side. Straight pass, flag down. Pass is going to be well short and incomplete, intended for Tito Gonzalez. And we'll check the flag. It came right at the line of scrimmage. See what the head linesman had to say to the referee. We've got a legal procedure apparently against West Virginia. I would assume they're going to take it.
Illegal formation. Number 62, offense, was not up on the line of scrimmage. Penalties declined. Fourth down.
That was Stanchek who was not up on the line of scrimmage. And you have to keep in mind, you've got to have six guys there, right, that are actually on the line
exactly.
of scrimmage.
And, you know, that's something. West Virginia only has 3.6 penalties per game, so they're not a very penalized team. I'm sure Rich Rodriguez will address that with his best offensive line to stand up.
And the clock has run out on the first quarter. It's all West Virginia. Rich Rodriguez Club looking for another win, their sixth of the year. And it's been a happy homecoming so far. Some turnovers and penalties have hurt Mississippi State. 28-0, West Virginia after one. First 15 minutes, it's been all West Virginia. 28-0, along with Renee Nadeau, I'm John Sanders. We're in Morgantown on what has turned out to be a very pleasant Saturday afternoon. And there are two Heisman candidates together on the same team here, and it's happened before, right?
Yeah, John, you were at one of the awards. Jack Snow was number four. Rex Kern was 7-3, Otis 3, and Jack Tatum was number 10. And there's been 10 times this has happened that you've had teammates, multiple teammates on the same team as Heisman candidates.
McAfee will attempt a field goal. It'll be a 42-yard field goal attempt from the left hash. Plenty of leg, plenty of distance, and good. So the first play of the second quarter is not a touchdown, but it's a McAfee field goal. There is the tandem of 5 and 10. You walk around at the tailgate parties. Everybody either wears number 10, number 5, or a few Rebels wear 35.
Well, you know, there's good reason for all of those. They all have a lot of following, and they're all the kind of players you want to look up to, a role model. So that's good. You know, you see kids with the jerseys and stuff like this, and Steve Slade, Patrick White, and Owen Schmidt, all the kind of players that, you know, you wouldn't mind marrying your daughter, if you will. And they represent the school, the Big East, very, very well.
And also during the break there, at the end of the first quarter, they introduced the Mountaineer basketball team, and it will be a team that has had a lot of success under John Beilein, but instead it's Bob Huggins taking over at his alma mater. And I talked to him on Thursday. He said he's delighted to be back in Morgantown.
And I know you're very familiar with the round ballers, and they should be very interesting, and it won't be long before Bob Huggins has everyone in the country knowing about the Mountaineer basketball program.
And he's posing for pictures. In fact, I think he was leading the parade on High Street, the homecoming parade last night on High Street in downtown Morgantown.
Well, I tell you, he's smiling like he slept with a hanger in his mouth. You know, he's grinning from ear to ear.
And he's happy to be here. Now, Mississippi State has had the ball to start a possession. This one is loose again. Who's got it? And it looks like the Bulldogs have it. Aubrey Bell, I think, was the guy that came up with it, but will unpile underneath. Shelton got the recovery to keep possession. That could have been disastrous right there.
Ouch, and this could have been bad. This is, again, an opportunity that Mississippi State can ill afford to have the ball, not only turn the ball over, but deep in their own territory, and just hand the ball over to West Virginia with an opportunity to score more points. It hits a guy, he jumped up in the air, didn't get a good grab at it.
And he kicked it.
And he kicked the ball, but made matters worse, kicked away from all teammates. But they do have possession. Wesley Carroll hopefully can muster some type of offense this series.
Well, Jala was the closest to getting to that football for West Virginia and could not come up with it. Dixon, stutter step. He's got about three.
Taking off here.
Chris Neld made the tackle. You see Hathaway in there defensively now, Bobby Hathaway. One of the seniors, a backup at linebacker, backing up Reed Williams, who leads the Mountaineers in tackles. But they've got enough bodies. I was at practice the other day. They've got about 125 guys in uniform at practice. That's unbelievable.
Yeah. And you know, the thing when you're playing Dixon, you know he's going to run run those gaps and stuff. And you know, the guys up front just shoot the gaps and just control those gaps, and that certainly changes the way he's going to run up the line.
Well, they showed a five-man rush, backed out of it to four, and Dixon will be knifed under as he gets back to the line of scrimmage. Morty Ivey, who has 38 tackles and four sacks coming into the game. He's one of those Pittsburgh, Western Pennsylvania players played from Monroeville, Pennsylvania. Morty Ivey.
You know, last year, Dixon, 9 totes, 15 yards. It kind of feels like he has something to prove this game, but he's having a rough go thus far, John. I don't think
so far, yeah. Because they're showing him a five-man front, and they'll back out of it, and they'll come up and split those gaps, as you said. They're giving him a different look.
And it's confusing that quarterback. They're not sure if they're coming with a blitz or not.
It's going to be third down and four. Long was the motion man. They'll kick it out to Dixon. That's incomplete. And even if he catches it, Renee, he's not going anywhere, I don't think.
No, West Virginia is running. They react very, very well. And you can see as he delivers the ball, everyone is really skating to that spot where the ball is going to be delivered. You see Carroll dropping back, trying to sell. He's going to the right, throwing to that way. But you see a bunch of gold jerseys right there on Dixon, even if he catches it. But I think you heard footsteps that time, and he's getting a little tentative.
It's one thing that Coach Kroom talked about that he feared the most was the speed of West Virginia, both offense, defense, special teams, and this is not an especially good kick either. Gets a little bit of a bounce. Rivers has it. He'll go down after a return of about three on the play. Once again, pretty good field position for the Mountaineers, a 31-yard kick. Well, West Virginia set to go back to work, and they've done plenty so far. It's 31-0 Mountaineers with 13:10 left to halftime. Also celebrating their soccer team a little bit. Halloween's 11 days away, but the Goblins are certainly out in Morgantown, especially if you're Mississippi State. We'll tell you more about that soccer team in a moment. Again, good field possession. The ball at the 39-yard line out of the I formation. Straight ahead running, nothing there. It'll be a no-gainer. He's pushed back. A lot of folks in there. Cheney was there. The UConn men's soccer team came to town last night. They were ranked number one in the country, and they lost to West Virginia 1-0. A walk-on scored the only goal of the night last night. So things are pretty happy right now here in Morgantown, West Virginia. Out of the gun with Schmidt and Slayton alongside, it's Patrick White. Broke that 64-yard run on his first carry this afternoon. Straight pass. Throws. Schmidt makes the catch. tackled from behind as he gets back to the line of scrimmage. That was Titus Brown, who stayed with him, a senior from Tuscaloosa, Alabama.
Boy, this says a lot for a 6'3", 250-pound, one of the best pass rushers in the SEC. Watch, he peels off from his defensive end position, smells us out, good pursuit, and catches him from behind. You know, he's a 4'6", 6'6" guy, and a defensive end. The pro scouts love this guy as a pass rusher.
Well, he goes back to the tight end. White looking, throwing. Intercepted. Intercepted by Bobo. Intended for Hogan, but it was short, and Bobo was right there to make the test. Demario Bobo gets his second interception of the season.
He runs an out route, and Patrick White is rolling that way. It throws where there's two white jerseys, and just threw a little behind. He throws on the outside. It's complete. Throws on the inside where Bobo was stationed, and that was Patrick White's second interception of the season, but only mistake he's made thus far.
K.J. Wright deflected it. I think that ball was deflected. That's the reason it came up short. Somebody got a piece of it from midfield. This is the second best field position that they have had. Dupree is in the lineup. And he will get inside West Virginia territory. Johnny Holmes makes the tackle. Let's go back and see this pass deflection that set up the interception right there.
Yes, you can see the way the ball is, the trajectory has changed a little bit. It's deflected. It's not a spiral anymore. And
it's a good catch by Bobo, though, to
make
the play.
Good concentration, John.
Well, the Mountaineers turn it over for the first time, and that is the first time that they have not scored points when they've had an offensive possession. 11 and a half to go till halftime. Out of the I formation again. But it's Dupree now as the tailback behind Hoskins. Fake to Dupree, pressure on the freshman, down he goes. Johnny Dingle with sack number 6, and there is a flag down.
Johnny Dingle, flag on the play.
Johnny Dingle is a load, I'm telling you that. 270, looks bigger than that. He's from Miami. That was his 6th sack of the year.
He's a highly regarded 2003 signee with the Florida Gators. But he's really turned it up a notch this season, knowing his senior season. Good size, 6'3", 270, could be a good rusher on the edge.
Face mask, number 92, defense.
So it's on Dingle.
5-yard penalty from the
previous
spot.
That's how he got back there, I guess.
Replay second down.
Well, it's a 5-yard penalty for an incidental face mask, and so Carroll will get another chance with some positive yards.
He does everything right except grab the iron.
Yep, he did grab it, just barely.
And he pulled it around. You know, the thing about this is a multiple pro-style offense. The running game, it's imperative. The running game is successful for this offense to work, John. And when you do play action, it's not going to sell anybody. And that's really why Dingle and company were in the backfield.
Well, it's Wesley Carroll with a 52% rating coming in. 52% of his passes. And he'll send two wideouts to the left side. Hoskins is the fullback. You've got Long and Bell both split to the left. Tight end is Sherrod. Dupree. Very close to a first down. Keelan Dykes makes the tackle right at the Mountaineer 40-yard line. We are at Mountaineer Field at Milan Puskar Stadium. Mississippi State against the team ranked number 9 in the BCS. That's West Virginia. They are ranked 7th in the coaches poll, 9th in the AP poll, and 9th in that all-important BCS. They're going to measure to see if he got the first down.
We'll look at Sylvester Kroon, who's coached for the Green Bay Packers, Detroit Lions, San Diego Chargers, Buccaneers, and the Colts.
And, of course, he coached WVU's offensive coordinator, Calvin McGee.
Calvin McGee, a native of New Orleans, and he played for Southern University and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Wow.
Well, as if they haven't had enough to cheer about here in Morgantown, they start the wave. I thought that's when you got bored. They can't be bored. It's 31 to nothing.
We got 3 quarters to go. Obviously, they have to go for this. You know, you talked a little bit about Wesley Carroll. 33 attempts against the Bowls last week. A couple of scoring tosses. But, you know, this running game must move for him to open up things a little bit. They'll have to make some adjustments. They really got Dixon bottled up, West Virginia defense.
Well, they've got Dixon back in there right now at the tailback spot after Christian Dupree, a transfer from Tulane, ran a couple of plays. But now it's Dixon again. McCray split wide left. It's a power line formation. Two tight ends, Sherrod and Butler, for the Bulldogs, trying to pick up a first down. Dixon will have it inside the 40 to the 39, and that is their first down of the afternoon. Bobby Hathaway on the tackle.
Good blocking by Blackledge and Strouder. Make that Jenkins on the right side allow, gave him a little cushion, converging, as you see, trying to block up front for him, and Blackledge's center did a good job for him.
It took him 19 and a half minutes to pick up a first down. We've still got 10 to go here in this opening half. 31-0 Mountaineers. Now they go back and spread two wideouts to the left, one to the right. And Dixon is the running back, and the pass over the middle is complete. Anthony Bell makes the catch. He'll be brought down near the 27-yard line by Johnny Holmes, and that is his first completion of the afternoon.
And Bell makes his eighth grab. Good protection as Carroll drops back, delivers the ball. See him right here, just a little curl right in the middle. And that's, I like this because you have to loosen things up. You can't go deep and vertical until you loosen up that defense a little bit and get them thinking pass, at least give your quarterback some confidence, your offensive line. So if you have to work the ball down the field with short passing game, that works.
Ducree is back in there at running back. They'll go from the gun with the two freshmen, Wesley Carroll, running the offense. Three wideouts left. Play fake. No, the handoff is to Ducree, who gets down to maybe about the 31. JT Thomas, who's been battling injuries and suspensions this year. We weren't sure that Thomas was going to play because of a hamstring problem. He's in there. You see him making that play. Of course, Wicks is one of the veterans in that secondary.
It's a handoff to Ducree, following his blockers. Good pull right there and block. And Ducree, as you said, played a two-in. He's not played a two-in in the early 90s. And he's out of Mandeville, Louisiana. They're glad to have me. Adds a little dimension, and it backs up, gives Anthony Dixon a blow now and then.
Again, it's third and short. McCray has split left. They've got double tight ends in Sherrod and Butler. Dixon. No, will not get there. Excuse me, it's Ducree, not Dixon. And Ducree is not going to pick up the first down. Once again, big Johnny Dingle there defensively for the Mountaineers. And only his face mask had that sack taken away earlier. So it's fourth down and four. You see Carroll comes off. The entire offensive unit heads over to the bench because the kick team's going to come on.
They blew it up right there, and also a good penetration by Antonio Lewis and company. And so good penetration by the West Virginia defense.
And Mississippi State is going to take their first timeout, just trying desperately, Renee, to get something going, down 31 to nothing. Mountaineers still have all three of their timeouts remaining, and they've got the huge lead. Scored 28 in the first quarter, leading now by 31. And the Bulldogs of Coach Kroom trying to get something going. And they're going to go for it. I thought they were going to bring out the kicking team. They called time and decided to go for it. Anthony Dixon back in there as the tailback. And they're going to go out of the shotgun. Movement on the left side. Now that may change this strategy right here. Everything that could go wrong pretty much has gone wrong here in the first half.
Looks like Eric Butler may have moved prematurely, number 88.
Before the snap, false start, number 88, offense. 5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
Third penalty against Kroom's club, 15 yards in penalties, and that will bring on the kicking team.
Now you look at Sylvester Kroom, you think of that song, Mama Said There'll Be Days Like This.
Yep, well, it has been so far. McAdams will kick. Von Rivers is standing inside his own 10-yard line. And the penalties, the turnovers at costly points, that's the thing of it.
Yeah, and West Virginia has made them pay for every opportunity they've gotten, every gift.
Kind of pooches that kick down there, and Rivers is going to run away from it, but it's going to take a good bounce for State to the one. 37-yard kick, but effective because it sets them down inside the 1-yard line.
And in that last break, they introduced the women's basketball team here, Renee, and they are getting some attention around the country. They finished fourth in the Big East last year. Mike Carey's their coach, and they are ranked in the top 20. One of the good news for the women's basketball team, a young lady by the name of Meg Bulger, who's had all kinds of physical problems, is back for her redshirt senior season. You might have heard of her brother, Mark.
I've heard him somewhere before, you know, and she's quite a player.
Yes,
an inspiration. You know, a story like that, John, is really going to motivate the rest of her teammates to see where she's come back from and what she can do.
Well, you see Bob Huggins is still with us down on the field. Now, this is the first time the Mountaineers have had bad field position. And they're going to try to power it out behind the running of Owen Schmidt. Kyle Love, number 95, was there defensively. We've got John Butera up here doing our stats today. And since electronically everything is done on computers at these stadiums, but the system here is out. So John's gone through three pens already.
And numerous pads.
But he's hanging in there.
And he does a great job. He has the calculator and the shoes and socks off.
That's right.
So we won't miss a yard.
Got all the toes and fingers working for him. Second down. Schmidt again is the lone setback. Schmidt trying to get outside, won't do it. They stuffed him right at the line of scrimmage. Bowen and Douglas that time, and they're not going to let him run up the middle on this play. They're going to force him to go outside.
And this could be a motivation to the offense if the defense can somehow hold West Virginia down this far near their goal line and somehow get the ball back in good field position. So a defensive stand here can certainly motivate the offense, but boy, I tell you what, it's tough to keep this offense bottled up, this spread offense. And again, we said earlier, Mississippi State never faces this.
Well, they do not use Schmidt this time. They throw the football downfield, overthrown. It was intended for Darius Raynaud. The fans and Raynaud wanted a call on the play, and they decided to go for it. I'm kind of surprised, I think, that they didn't move quite around a little bit more on that play.
Yeah, he was more of a drop back there, and although he's second in the Big East in passing efficiency, he just dropped back and threw. But Raynaud with just a go routing could find a pretty good coverage by Mississippi State.
Pegues and Long are deep, and right from the dead back of the end zone, it'll be Pat McAfee to do the punting. Out of the snap of Adam Hughes. End over end. Pegues at the 30. Dragged down from behind, and that will be the best field position Mississippi State has had this entire ball game. Tippy Hale made the tackle. You know, the difference, a 39-yard kick with a 9-yard return that time. Total yards for West Virginia, 233. For the Bulldogs, 37.
And last series defensively was pretty good for Mississippi State. And again, that was all started by that good punt that was down to the 1-yard line. Kind of took away some of the options that.
Sure did. They did not take any chances. And actually, the last pass play was basically overthrown and thrown away.
Just thrown away. And it was set up that punt and kind of lived the fight another day.
Well, we'll see. It's 31-0. Hoskins, Dixon in the I formation. If you won't see Hoskins carry the ball, you will see Dixon play action fake. Under pressure, the throw is caught at the 10. It'll be first and goal for the Bulldogs. Good throw that time by the freshman because he got some pressure. Smith made the reception. A 22-yard pickup. Jamel Smith with the catch.
And Jamel Smith just runs a deep dig as Wesley Carroll just drops back, waits for him to make a break, and right inside. Pretty good pattern at his zone coverage, number two, and nice throwing catch, and Jamel Smith with his 17th grab of the season, a walk-off.
And it was once again Dingle who was in there defensively. They line up again in the I formation. Two wide receivers to the near side, one in the slot. Also in there is Burks. Dixon hesitates, five. He's going to be wrestled down right at the line of scrimmage. That is the veteran Eric Wicks from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, the redshirt, or the senior, who makes the tackle.
And the thing is, you got to get Dixon running downhill, north-south, not east-west, and they make him bounce outside. Dixon starts there, and look, he's running sideways here, and you cannot do that. He has to put those shoulders, square those shoulders, and run north and south, and when you do that, you won the battle.
Second and goal from the 7, did not pick up anything. Clock running. Dixon fights his way down to about the 2.5-3 yard line. Johnny Holmes makes the tackle from his linebacker spot. But some positive yards that time by Dixon. We showed you Dixon, right? This is kind of where he excels down here in these short yardage situations.
He's a red zone type runner, and good field shot right here as Dixon just lowers those shoulder pads, good pad level, and digging, good blocking on Greg Jenkins as part of the 75.
Absolutely.
And gets him close where he can step. They need a score here as we under the five-minute mark. Good look at Keelan Dykes.
Ball's at the three, third and three. Hoskins, the fullback in front of Dixon. Double tight, lone wide receiver is McRae. No, he will not get there. This time it's Hathaway stepping up defensively for the Mountaineers, and Dixon is denied again. Do they try to punch it in here on fourth down, or do they take three?
I think you have to go for the three, and this is just good feel right here as you see the linebacker coming across, Hathaway and company, along with Wicks, just filling that gap and giving him nowhere to run. I don't know. You know, it's close here. I guess 6-1, half dozen, but you need points this series. You definitely need points as you approach the halftime.
It's at the one-yard line. Sherrod and Butler, the double tight, and we've got a timeout. The second one taken by the Bulldogs.
You have to make this call right, John, and make sure you want points. You do not want to get shut down short of the end zone because that could really demoralize you as you're down by 31 points. You need points any way you can get it.
You know, I tell you what, too, if you figure that your biggest weapon, it's a first and goal at the 7-yard line, is Dixon, you're going to go to him in this situation. You're going to go to him on fourth down, too, I would think.
Exactly. And the thing is, he has not had much success running against this Mountaineer defense, which is fifth rated in the entire country.
Well, be sure to stay with us for halftime. We'll have comments from the field. And we'll also update scores and standings. And once again, some surprises again in college football. We'll have highlights of the first half. We'll check off the stats. Halftime from Morgantown. It's all coming up in about 4 minutes football time.
Let me give you a superlative, John. West Virginia, one of three schools that is in the top 16 in scoring offense, total offense, scoring defense, and total defense. The other two, Kansas and Boise State.
Kind of interesting. Wow, it is interesting. Well, this is a Mississippi State team that has rushed for at least 135 yards six straight games, and they are not there so far this afternoon. Three tight ends. Hoskins in front of Dixon. Dixon flags down. He's going to be in the end zone, but let's wait and see because we've got a flag. Ryan Mundy made the tackle. It is good for a touchdown, but if it's illegal procedure, it could be a very painful penalty. Again, at the wrong time for Mississippi
offsides,
State.
Offsides, number 96, defense.
Oh, it's against.
Penalties declined.
It's a touchdown.
Touchdown.
That was Keelan Dykes who was offside on the play. So that time they did not shoot themselves in the foot. They get six. Adam Carlson now for the extra point. He is 19 of 20. In point afters, and he'll get a chance here. Out of the hold of McAdams. And he drills it through. It is 31-7. There was a little confusion on the fourth down and one play, but the offsides went against West Virginia. And Dixon cutting it outside, lowers his head, takes on his defender, gets in the zone. 31-7 WVU. All right, we get set for the kickoff after the touchdown by Mississippi State. They forced it into the end zone, so the defense regrouping. It took them five plays to go 29 yards, and Dixon picks up another touchdown. He has been a touchdown machine for the Bulldogs. Dixon, that's his 11th rushing touchdown of the year.
Which leads the SEC.
That's impressive. Raynaud, Rivers, and Sanders are deep to receive the kick. And it is taken by Raynaud inside the end zone. Raynaud tries to go back outside and slips down as he gets across the 20 to the 21-yard line. Bobo up there. Bobo who had that interception earlier in the ballgame. Raynaud is cut down, but he'll stick around.
You know, a little interesting story about Raynaud. You know, if you think of the guys who are the hold the squat record on this team, you think of the Stan Checks or the Keelan Dykes. No, it's Darius Raynaud with a squat of 695. Tremendous explosion in those legs.
At the 21, Mountaineers will have it. First and 10. White has gone the distance at quarterback. It's Schmidt and Slayton split alongside him as he works out of the shotgun. Two wide receivers left, another wide receiver to the right. Inside handoff, Slayton, nothing there. Columbia lost a yard as he was banged back. Dominic Douglas leading the way in there along with Avery Hannibal. Strong defense that time. And certainly, I think getting the touchdown probably picks up your entire attitude.
It really does. You know, it spills over to the offense and the defense, and when special teams do well, and that's certainly that touchdown and that defensive stand, which made West Virginia punt last series, also spilled over to this defensive effort.
Loss of one, second and 11. White out of the gun with Slayton. Just over three to play. White dropped it, and he gets it back. Hannibal falls on top of him, but he was able to get it back.
You can see Patrick White just...
I think he had it knocked out of his hand.
Yeah, he did. I did not think he was expecting that exchange, and he was just going to do a play-action fake type of thing and draw the defense and kind of caught him off guard a little bit.
Well, this is obviously the worst possession so far for the Mountaineers. They've not had many go wrong so far. It's going to be third down and 16 with 2.5 to play in the opening half. With Renee Nato, I'm John Sanders. Glad to have you with us on Homecoming. We've got four wideouts in this formation. Here comes the blitz. White rolls away from it. Looks, still looking, and runs out of bounds. Pegues putting on some pressure. And a good defensive series that time for the Bulldogs from Mississippi State.
And I think you got to credit the defense with this because, you know, besides the pressure, the defensive backfield, he didn't have anywhere to throw to. He couldn't plant his feet. Everyone was covered, so he just tucks it and goes. And so that was a good effort by the defensive backfield and good pressure up front.
I'll tell you what, if he'd put his head down and tried to pick extra yardage, his body would have felt it. There were like four white shirts out there waiting for
it. It's not worth it right now with a 24-point advantage.
Pegues and Long are deep. The punt comes from McAfee. Man, it's a good one. Very good. Pegues backpedals to the 31-yard line. Now tries to get outside. Gets a block right there. And out to the 40-yard line before he's banged down. Halfway on the coverage along with Larry Williams. A 53-yard kick and a 9-yard return.
Great tackle by backup fullback tight end Sam Marone. And boy, he just waylaid him. He's feeling good about himself. He hardly ever catches the ball or sees the ball at all. So when you make a special teams play like that, John.
Well, when you got two tight ends ahead of you, basically, because you have to consider Schmidt in that group as well, it's pretty tough. For the last three possessions for West Virginia, a turnover, a couple of now three and outs. So they have struggled a little bit more. Actually, two three and outs on their last two. Downfield, caught. That's the 30-yard line. That's Co-Eric Riley, number 15, who made the catch and a big gain out of the hands of the freshman quarterback, Wesley Carroll, 30 yards.
Co-Eric Riley, and this was a well-delivered play as Co-Eric Riley just runs downfield. And this is a tough throw between the defensive backs,
wow,
between three of them. And that ball had it delivered. It was a very small window of opportunity. He throws it too short one way or the other, and it's intercepted. That was quite a throw, a big-time throw.
First catch for Riley. Dixon is in there, and that was the play fake to Dixon that really set that pass play up. There it is again. Here's the pressure. Down he goes. Back to the 37-yard line. Johnny Dingle, no fast face mask there. He's going to get another sack.
Dingle, again, has really turned it up a notch this season. The coaches are very, very happy with his effort. He had six stops, a sack, and two tackles for loss against Maryland. The 2007 season has been his coming out party, if you will. And he was flushed from the outside. Give credit also to Mark Magro.
Absolutely. Magro was right there to force
he
him up
flushed
into
him
Dingle.
Inside and flushed him right into Dingle.
And that's a good combination that you like to see. If your linebackers come and force it back to those big men in the middle, there's no place for the QB to go.
And that's interesting because in this three-man front, usually it's the defensive guys who suck up and absorb those blockers so that, you know, they're like press agents for the linebackers,
that's
make
right.
them look good. So for once, Magro kind of turns it around and allows Dingle for a sack.
And that's especially true with the defense that they run here, the 3-4-5, and the leading tacklers, Magro, Andrews, Williams, Ivy, they are the guys that most of the time do the job.
And they do a good job with that 3-3-5. You know, they can blitz you from everywhere. The spar linebacker, he lines up on the tight end, bandit. You know, it just, they move so many moving parts and can confuse you. It's tough on a freshman quarterback like a Carroll to read this defense.
And remember, at halftime, we will have some scores of other games, and there are some surprises. As you, what not, what to expect? That happens every week, doesn't it? What new?
It's the norm.
Ball to the 37-yard line. Bell and Burks of the wideout split near side. Wesley on the run, throws over everybody's head, out of bounds. Closest to it was Larry Williams, the senior from Highland Springs, Virginia, but there was the quarterback. Wesley Carroll simply threw it away.
Morty Ivey, from his weak linebacker position, had nothing to do with the play except put pressure and force Carroll out of the pocket and throw sooner than he wanted to. That caused the incompletion.
We are in the final minute 14 of this opening half, and it's a half that has been dominated by West Virginia. But since that field goal to start the second quarter, Mississippi State's been very much in it.
They've turned it around, and I'm sure there'll be some halftime adjustments in the next 74 ticks. But Mississippi State has looked good the last two series.
And they've moved Magro up to that defensive line, makes it basically a four-man line. Pass formation, over the middle, caught, dropped. That would have been well short of the first down anyway. Jason Husband, one of the tight ends, they used the three, Sherrod, Butler, and Husband, and it was Husband who could not hang on to that one. So it's fourth down.
And Husband, who was a number one wide receiver in Mississippi coming out of high school, just curls up. He's got pretty good hands usually with five grabs, just drops one. And the big senior out of Jackson, Mississippi, big incomplete.
So on fourth down, they will kick it away. A little bit of hesitation, and Rivers is going to go back to receive this punt. And both kickers have done pretty well so far. This is going to be Blake McAdams. Pat McAfee's had a good afternoon kicking for West Virginia. He's been busier, of course, with the four PATs and the one field goal. And we have a flag down, delay of game. And set them back five more. Well, one thing that Coach Kroom talked about was the speed, and obviously you start with the speed on offense, but he said their speed is there on defense, so he says, you know the speed's there on their special teams as well.
Yes, and a lot of these guys who play offense and defense play special teams as well. It spills over.
Trying to get outside, but Rivers will not do it. He was forced down on the play. Now he's still on his feet. Rivers, it looked like he was tackled on the play. But Rivers stayed alive. The first man to get to him down there, it looked like Cheney would have him covered, but he got away. So that's an excellent job to get some positive yards out to the 30-yard line, a 31-yard kick.
Vaughn Rivers, a number one punt returner of the Big East with a 22.6 yards per. Boy, he's a jack of all trades. You see he's just running away from pursuit here. Doesn't go down, puts
nope.
The arm out.
He kept the knee off the ground and
keeps
got an extra 5 yards or so.
Great individual effort.
It's at the 30, first and 10. So Vaughn Rivers does his part on the return. Inside handoffs. Layton for about two. Maybe now with an extra effort gets it out for about four. Avery Hannibal on that defensive end made the tackle. And Slayton has really had to earn his yards. He had that one big play on the pass play, but for the most part, they've been tough to come by for him.
Really have. They've been keeping him in check. And again, we talked about it. He gets 55% of his productivity in the second half, so we'll see how he bounces back in the third and fourth quarter.
Fake the inside handoff. The quick out pass goes to Raynaud, and he's not going anywhere either. Fitzhugh is there. Keith Fitzhugh from Hampton, Georgia, a junior. Wrapped that play up quickly. And you don't expect West Virginia to play at the high tempo they did in the first quarter. Their things have really slowed down. It's hard when you score 28 straight points, you know?
And a lot of those were gifts in good field position, and they took advantage of the situation.
That will take us to halftime. The last team to get on the board was Mississippi State. They trail 31-7. And the Mountaineers will regroup and go to the halftime locker room. I think the good news for West Virginia was that great run to start the ball game, of course, by quarterback Patrick White, and the fact that White played the entire first half, although he did take one hit up high, which is the danger area for him.
And I'm sure they're not going to put him in any kind of situation. If for some reason West Virginia is lucky enough to put any more cushion between these two teams, you may see a change of quarterback.
Well, we'll see how that goes, but it's pretty much still dominated by West Virginia as they are up 31-7, but after the first snap in the second quarter, they had a 31-0 lead. So you'd have to say that the Bulldogs won the second quarter.
Yeah, they really did, and they made some adjustments. They stymied West Virginia offense just a little bit in the last two or three series. They held them down inside their five and that type of thing, made a punt. and a couple of times. So I think you have to credit the defense with stepping up. And something you mentioned, John, that touchdown by Dixon certainly has been an impetus to the defense and really sparked this entire team.
But I think also after they scored on their first four possessions, actually first five if you count the field goal that they had, and you see Bob Huggins being introduced and down on the field here at halftime. We're going to have a chat with him a little bit later on. But I think some of the spark went out of that offense for West Virginia. It was not the same.
And that's something that Rich Rodriguez and his staff going to have to address. You have to play this game like a 0-0 at halftime, throw the 24-point advantage out the window, and just start from scratch.
The bands are getting set to take the field. It is homecoming in Morgantown, and for the most part, the Mountaineers have had everything their way. Whether White is throwing, running, whatever, he has been terrific in the first half. It's 31-7. Our halftime coverage begins after this. So we'll see how much of him we see in the second half, Renee. And, of course, the other side of that coin is the ability of that team to hang in there under Coach Sylvester Kroom when they fell behind 31-0. Let's take a look how this breaks down statistically. Obviously, early on, it was all West Virginia.
And you had to think that he showed some Rocky Balboa footage getting knocked down the campus and getting back up again. Sylvester Kroom did.
And you see the difference in offense. Pretty even in terms of the passing yards, although really, the Bulldogs didn't start throwing the ball much until that second quarter when they had to try to get back in the ball game. A couple of sacks for West Virginia, two turnovers, a couple of fumbles by the Bulldogs, and that one fumble by West Virginia. But a decided edge statistically, obviously, as they were 4 of 9 on third down, and they just kept moving the football.
Very optimistic, too. West Virginia has made the most of their opportunities, and when they've gotten a gift from Mississippi State, they've made the Bulldogs pay for it.
And there is head coach Rich Rodriguez, who enjoyed the first half. At least I would say he enjoyed the first 16 minutes. And Mississippi State pretty much played him even after that field goal that got them to 31-0 to start the second quarter of play. Let's go back and revisit Renee's keys and see how you did.
Well, Mississippi State controlled the clock, run the ball. They haven't done either one of those recognized formations. It's been tough to get a beat or a read on either Slayton or Patrick White. So Mississippi State finds themselves 24 points down.
And that is the situation as White apparently is going to come out to start. Here are your keys. They did create a couple of turnovers, did the Mountaineers?
They did. A couple of turnovers. They are plus six in that situation. Control the tempo. They've done a good job confusing Carroll, but he's kind of got a little more confidence towards the end of the second quarter.
Well, the first five possessions, their tempo was just blazing, and there was nothing that the Bulldogs could do about that. So we'll see how the freshman Carroll can do in the second half as we get set to start the next 15 minutes of play. And I mentioned that West Virginia has a date at Rutgers, and that'll be coming up next week. Now, you look at the wins that Mississippi State has had. They had the one at Auburn, and they also had a win last year at Alabama.
Yeah.
So it's not like it's been all desperate for them.
Well, you know, they signed 34 players this season, 11 junior colleges, so the future is now.
Well, they've got a game next week at Kentucky. West Virginia will be kicking off, but Geese is deep to receive the second half kickoff from Pat McAfee.
Derek McGee, deep to receive.
31-7 Mountaineers. We are underway in the third quarter, and he squibs it downfield. It's going to be taken by Justin Williams. Williams played a lot against Tennessee last week, but Justin has not played too much this afternoon. That's a decent 21-yard return. Give him good field position. Nate Sowers made the tackle defensively. The ball is out to the 42-yard line. There's Nate.
Boy, a great terrific athlete, a converted quarterback who plays some defense, and outstanding on special teams, Nate Sowers.
So the Bulldogs will have it. See how they do on this possession. They can dig in. Bell will be split left. Dixon is the lone setback. You've got Burks to the right, Bell to the left, and Husband, the tight end, is in the slot. Passing on first down, incomplete. Just out of the reach that time of Husband. Husband, the senior from Jackson, Mississippi, not able to get to that one. A little change in pattern there as they immediately went to the pass. And what made the pass plays work, I thought, in the second quarter was the fact that you had Dixon in there as the decoy.
Exactly right. That's a good observation. And the thing on that last play, John, is they brought five West Virginia did. And again, with that 3-3-5 defense, they could bring from anywhere, and that confused Carroll just a bit, made him throw the ball sooner than he wanted.
Burks and Long are split to the near side, Bell to the far side. Long set back Dixon, second down 10, just underway third quarter. Dixon tries the left side. He'll get five and is dragged down from behind by the ever-present 92, Johnny Dingle.
Johnny Dingle comes from the right defensive end all the way across. Tremendous, really, pursuit from Johnny Dingle all the way. He's right there on the top of the screen, and he chases down Dixon from behind. Great first step, good explosion, and 6'3", 270, he's moving.
Well, he got a little bit of help from Malik right at the end, but you're right, he ran down a good runner. They'll get about three on the play. It'll be third down and seven. First possession of the second half for the Bulldogs. Big third down and long play coming up here. Four on the line of scrimmage, maybe five. Yeah, he's coming on the outside. Carroll throws, caught. First down. That went to Burks. Tony Burks made the catch, and he'll get inside West Virginia territory down to about the 47-yard line. Lewis and Holmes made the tackle. But a good play there.
And Burks, big target at 6'4", 217. Really just a good catch right in the middle. And he was a junior college All-American, the seventh best junior college wide receiver. And in a 75-yard touchdown against Kentucky.
Well, we now have Stallworth in there as the tailback. Carroll has picked it up a little bit. A very slow start. He had a lot of pressure early on, but he's thrown it much better in the second and now the third quarters. Dogs get the first down. They fake the handoff and then dump it out into the flats, and that's going to be another first down for Mississippi State. Hoskins, who does not carry the ball at all. Malik ran him out, but Hoskins that time picks up 11 and a first down.
And everybody went with Jason Husband. All the West Virginia players went downfield because they left Hoskins alone. Didn't anticipate him being a receiver, and he made his first grab of the season. And a big 5'11", 230-pound junior makes the Mountaineers pay.
Well, he doesn't carry the ball very often. He doesn't catch it very often. So Dixon is back in there as the lone setback. This back-to-back first downs now for the Bulldogs, showing some signs of life. Ball is at the 37-yard line. First down, 10. Dixon, no. The left side collapses, led by Reed Williams, the linebacker, and there was no place for Dixon to go. We are in Morgantown, West Virginia, what has turned out to be a very pleasant Saturday afternoon, plenty of sunshine. That brisk wind has died down a little bit. I'm John Sanders with Renee Nadeau. As we promised you, we will have a special guest or two coming up here in the third quarter because they had a brand new president installed here at West Virginia. You know, when we were here in September 1st, that was the last day of the old president, and then yesterday was the first day of the new president. What's also interesting is when West Virginia played at Mississippi State last year, that's when they got a new president who is a West Virginia graduate. So it's kind of strange. Dixon does get outside, dives forward. Williams giving chase over there, and he'll pick up positive yards.
Good blocking downfield by ex-receiver Jamal Smith allows Dixon to skirt up the side, and you can see as he's a little stretch left, he bounces.
And he can't get outside.
And look, Jamal Smith, number 89, blocking on the edge. Well, you see him at least attempting. And you know, the thing is, the wide receiver is not blocking. It's blocking the right person. And that's something that Rich Rodriguez in his offense stresses. You know, you have to block as a wide receiver, but block the right person.
Well, that's the play we saw them run successfully over and over again against Tennessee. Double tight, Sherrod and Butler with Dixon behind Hoskins. Play fake. Pressure running away as Carroll throws and caught for a first down inside the 25-yard line. And again, that's Hoskins, who's all of a sudden become a weapon out of the backfield. What's the deal with that?
Well, the Mississippi State coaching staff has to come up with a bag of tricks, and this is something they probably not going to focus a lot of attention on because he hasn't done much. But now he makes two big grabs in this series to come up with first down catches. As Carroll stays strong facing pressure. And
that's a good job of catching that ball, too. It was not an easy catch as the ball is at the 24-yard line. Well, Hoskins getting some work. Ninth play of this opening drive of the third quarter coming, and it's been a good, solid drive for the Bulldogs. Dixon, not this time. He'll be dropped for a yard loss, and it's Johnny Dingle again. How many times have we called his name today?
Good pressure up front, though. Good caving in from the outside with Antonio Lewis come up to. Didn't stop the play, but he turned it inside and allowed the pursuit to catch up with it. Johnny Dingle really, you know, his bio coming into the season, John, if an NFL scout said, kind of weak against the run, a pass rusher. He has dispelled all those rumors. So, you know, he's moved himself up the chart and gained the attention of the NFL scouts.
It is second down 11 for the Bulldogs, who loaded up on the right side. Dixon is still the lone setback. Carroll throws, incomplete. Intended again for Jason Husband, but Mark Magro was there with him. Magro, as I mentioned, a native of Morgantown, West Virginia. And you love those home down products.
The thing with Carroll that time, he locked into his receiver. He had a wide open Desmond Sherrod and chose not to go his way.
Stallworth is the tailback. Dixon now with 52 yards on 16 carries. That's much better than a year ago. Bell and Smith are the wide receivers. Smith goes left. Bell comes right. Another receiver in the slot. Shotgun formation for Wesley Carroll. Carroll looks, throws, far side, caught. Down at the 10-yard line. Again, it's Husband who made the reception. He got it. They'll gain 11 and get another first down. This is an impressive drive to start this third quarter.
And Carroll just stays strong in the pocket. He's looking at the receiver, waiting for his break. He delivers the ball just a little behind an athletic grab by Husband. Tough catch for the 6'3", 230-pounder senior, and keeps the chains moving.
It is first and goal from the 10. They'll have to go the whole 10 to get in there. Dixon, no, he is stuck for a loss of one. Dixon drilled by Ridwan Malik, getting the start. Malik started the first two games of the season and had not started until today, and Mark Magro, the senior, was also in on that play. But I tell you what, this kid, Wesley Carroll, has made some pretty good throws to keep this drive going.
He has gained confidence, as you can see, in 33 throws last week against Tennessee, and you can see his confidence has grown in leaps and bounds.
Ducree is now the tailback. Fake to Decree. Throw at the 5. Down to the 3 is Burks.
Carroll's pass complete. Tony Burks.
Again, Magro and Williams there defensively, but that big target that you talked about, 6'4 senior from Gulfport, Tony Burks.
And Burks had 4 grabs against the Mountaineers last year. He's got a second in this drive, and Burks just is a big target at 6'4, 217. Arkansas, Oklahoma State, Ole Miss all looked at him, but he decided to come to Mississippi State. And boy, I tell you, he's become Carroll's best receiver this drive.
Third and goal from the 3. Burks goes to the left. Ducree is still the running back. They also split Smith out. Ducree, touchdown, Mississippi State. Boy, that was an impressive drive for the Bulldogs. Just exactly what they needed to start the second half.
And give credit to the offensive line for giving Carroll protection and blowing on the right side. Hamilton and Jenkins, good blocking, good surge on the right side. And Ducree.
Oh, big hole.
Really, that was a nice little hole there. And, boy, he bounced it outside. And I tell you, Ducree, his second score of the campaign. And Mississippi State has made a game of this. They have had 13 unanswered points.
That's right. They have scored the last 2 touchdowns in the first play of the second quarter. They covered 58 yards in 13 plays and took over 5 minutes off the clock. Now they're going to go for 2. Trying to battle their way back into this game. They will test the Mounties defense here with a spread formation. Far corner, bobbled and incomplete. That was Jamel Smith, who was right there but could not hang on in front of Larry Williams defensively. So the 2-point try is no good. 9:50 to play. Bulldogs with an impressive drive. Cut into the lead. It's 31-13 West Virginia. These scenes were shot yesterday, the installation of a new president, Michael Garrison, taking over as the president of this outstanding and well-known university here in Morgantown, West Virginia University. Michael joins us now, and that had to be, as you received the honor, a very special honor for you, I'm sure.
John, very, very special honor. I'm humbled. I'm a native West Virginian.
Right.
And very, very humbled to be given this opportunity.
It's not too often, though, that you can go from being student body president to university president.
It really is a remarkable opportunity. And again, West Virginia is on the rise. We've got a lot going for us. We've got some native sons back home. We're excited about that.
Absolutely. You got a little cash in the coffers, too, this last week, huh?
We did. We had a record-breaking donation, one-time donation. We were excited about that.
All right. We'll stick you with us here for a few minutes. Stick
Absolutely.
With us, and we will take the kickoff, see if the Mountaineers can get something going with their offense. The kick is fielded by Raynaud, and he's going to get out across the 25. Now still fights his way through at the 30. Good job by Darius Raynaud to stay alive and get out to about the 34. Decent field position for the Mountaineers. So I know you've just really started. And I told you we were here on September the 1st, which was the end of the old regime.
That's right. That was actually my first day.
And the other part is Doc Fogelsberg, who is the president of Mississippi State, was installed when West Virginia was down there in Starkville last year. And he's from West Virginia.
That's right. He's a West Virginia native from Mingo County. And we're very proud of his success. He's a great guy. He's doing a great job down in Mississippi
State. Yes, he is. And he's a few booths down.
I thought he was.
Yeah, he's here.
I've got to stop down and see him.
Absolutely, you do. Well, I know there's a lot of challenges out there. There's so many projects. I mean, we look at what's being done here with all the renovation. But this is just a small part of it. You've got stuff going on everywhere.
Absolute renaissance going on right now in Morgantown and really throughout the state.
Well, Bobo was injured on that kickoff play. And so Jarrett Brown is going to come out and start the second half. Renee, that's something we thought we might see.
Well, yeah. And, you know, we'll see. There's no drop-off at all, John, when he comes in this game, and we talked about him. Maybe the second coming of Vince Young, if I can so crown this young man.
Well, he's going to throw a pass on the first play, and it is caught by Gonzalez, and a flag goes down. So we'll see what that is all about. Talk a little bit, if you could, Michael, about some of the projects that you do have going on here.
Well, we've started really hit the ground running. We, like a lot of campuses, we're taking student safety very seriously. We implemented a text messaging system here on campus, keep our students and faculty and staff safe.
15-yard penalty, first down.
And that's the major 15-yard penalty. That's going to give the Mountaineers a first down and good field position. It's sad that we've had to come to that day that you have to make sure that your system and everything works to help the students.
Unfortunate, but we're a very safe campus. We want to keep it that way. We have a great crime rate here in Morgantown, so we want to keep it and keep it as safe as possible.
Well, I also enjoy all the tailgating that goes on outside, but the good thing about that, I think, is that tailgating stays outside. It doesn't come inside this football
stadium. It does. Very, very good fans here.
Brown is the quarterback, and that's a quarterback draw. See what I mean? There's no drop-off. He was tripped up that time by Fitzhugh, but just barely. Thank you very much, Michael. Good luck
John,
to you and your presidency.
Thank you.
I'm sure we're going to see you many times over.
Look forward to seeing you next time you're in Morgantown.
I'll
you're
be
always
back.
Welcome here. Thank you both.
I appreciate it.
Very much. Thank you.
Good luck to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Really excited about the he seems really excited about, you know, his stepping into that huge role, and I'm sure he'll do a great job.
There's another flag. That time it was Slayton carrying around the left side. He doesn't look old enough to be a university president, you know?
Well, obviously he's earned where he is and gained respect, and I tell you, he's done a great job in getting into here and has the foresight to know what he needs to do. And boy, I tell you what, it's just sometimes it's tough to keep that ball rolling. Once a university has had a lot of success, to keep it going,
holding,
continuity.
Number 62, offense.
That's going to go on Ryan Stanchek. So it is a holding penalty. We'll bring it back the Mountaineers up.
And you can see Slayton has a hold on the edge there.
Yes, sir.
And a handful of Dominic Douglas jersey.
So it'll make it second down and long now.
We said that just under four penalties per game for the Mountaineers coming into this contest.
Brown starting the second half in place of White. Works with Slayton in the backfield and four wideouts in this formation. Now Slayton out into the flat. Makes the catch. Cuts it back. 50. Down to about a yard short of the original line of scrimmage. Bowman and Douglas were there defensively to slow down Slayton, who did break free for that record touchdown run in the first half, setting the all-time West Virginia touchdown record rushing. Of course, he can score passing as well. Anytime you can get him out there in the flat where he's only got one or two guys to concern himself with, Renee, he can be trouble.
And the thing is, you have to really pursue to get to him to turn him back inside. He'll kill you on the outside.
Brown, he's got some room, now throws. Maybe a little late getting that pass off, and it is knocked away and almost intercepted by O'Quinn.
I think maybe he hesitated just a bit as to whether he was going to run or pass, and the pass was a little late getting there.
And that's a little inexperienced here. He gets pursuit from the inside from Cheney, throws the ball. Nice throw to Jallo. Good break on the ball. Really a nice break by O'Quinn. Almost intercepted and knocks the ball away and forces the Mountaineers to punt the ball away. Another great defensive effort by the Bulldogs.
Pegues will be deep, standing at about his own 10-yard line to receive the punt of Pat McAfee. And again, we certainly appreciate Michael coming by, the new president of West Virginia University. A grad and a former student body president comes back to run the school. How about that? Pegues, right where he caught it, he swarmed under. Mundy was there. It's a 32-yard kick. And after that first good possession to start the third quarter, what do the Bulldogs do when we come back? We'll find out. It's 31-13 WVU. Well, Rich Rodriguez's team has some work to do here in the second half, still leading, though, 31-13. We've got a revolving door up here in the booth because Bob Huggins, the basketball coach, coming back to his alma mater, joins us. Bob, you were honored last night. How was it down on High Street for you on homecoming to be back here for where you went to school?
It was terrific. People have been absolutely wonderful.
Well, you've got a good basketball team. John Beilein, of course, did a great job while he was here, but I think the style's going to be a little bit different now, isn't it?
I'm going to try not to screw it up. Yes.
Coach, you got to feel good. You've had success everywhere you've been. What makes you feel good about this group?
They've been really coachable. You know, they've listened. They've really bought into what we're trying to do. Defensively, they're getting a whole lot better and starting to kind of think a little bit more the way we think.
Well, we are having Coach stick around and join us just a little bit up here. I saw you had a trophy. Was that from yesterday or was that from today?
That's being for the Grand Marshal of the parade.
Oh, okay.
If they make you the Grand Marshal, you'd get one of those.
Okay, I figured it would. I decided it was going to be too rainy to go down the High Street last night.
It really wasn't that bad. I was a little concerned about that myself.
But I know the guys are already practicing. You got to look forward to what's coming up. And from what I saw of your team the other day, it looks like some of your guys, and let's take Joe Alexander, for example, have beefed up a little bit.
We needed to get stronger. And we're not near strong enough yet, but we needed to get stronger.
Well, he did. I know he picked up about 25 pounds. Nichols looks like he's put on some weight as well.
They've worked at it. You know, they stayed here all summer and really worked at it and committed themselves to getting stronger. And I think it's really going to help us. I think it'll help us rebounding the ball, and I think it'll help us defensively.
Top to bottom, Coach, Big East, this is competitive. Week in and week out, there's no week off.
No, it's, and we're playing 18 games now, so it's tough. It's, you know, every day you got to come to play. But that's, you know, that's why you practice hard every day, and you kind of commit yourself to being good.
Good play by Langster to knock that ball away when it looked like Carroll might pull a Houdini act and get away and set up a big game. Instead, it's knocked away, and it makes it fourth down. Let's watch it again, Renee.
And Carroll drops back and just going through his options. Gets pressure from Wicks and company. He gets a little kiss from Morty Ivy, but throws the ball. It is Johnny Dingle once again. I think that's rush number 100 for this game. And Dingle has spent more time in the backfield than Herman Carroll has.
All right, let's see what happens on the punt. Of course, Dingle's not tall enough to play for you. He's only 6'3", Bob.
That's plenty tall enough. We're not very big. When I walk in a room and I'm as tall as everybody in there, it's not a good sign.
Rivers back, takes it at the 38-yard line, goes up that far sideline, some room, spins it back toward midfield and is ripped down inside the 30-yard line. An excellent return by Vaughn Rivers. Husband made the tackle, but a terrific return there. A 42-yard kick, and that was wiped out by a 36-yard return. Bob, we want to thank you again for joining us, and I know I'm going to see a lot more of you as the season goes along.
Well, I hope so. It's my pleasure. Great to see you.
Thank you. And there's the good return by Vaughn Rivers.
We might be able to press if we had some guys move like that.
I think you're probably right. Coach, thanks a million.
Thank you.
Always good to see you.
Great to see you.
Well, he's going to do an outstanding job with this program, John.
He's already been the Grand Marshal of Homecoming Parade. Had his team introduced at halftime. Well, West Virginia comes back, and they've got the great field position this time. Inside handoff. Slayton got away from a tackler and gets it inside the 20 down to the 16. Hughes on the tackle, but look at this. The first five possessions for the Mountaineers were four touchdowns and a field goal. The last five positions, one turnover, two three and outs, one the half ended, and one punt. So it's not been the same.
And, you know, remember we said this earlier that Slayton does most of his damage. 55% of his productivity comes in the second half, as does the Mountaineer offense. So if you have 31 points, who knows what could happen if they hit a get in back in stride again.
Schmidt is in there in the backfield because the other guys moved out to a wide receiver. You got wide receivers all over the place, and now Schmidt makes a shift from left to right. Brown running the offense to start the second half. Great chance for the Mountaineers. Quarterback draw. Brown dances his way down inside the 10-yard line. Brown able to keep his feet, pick up some positive yardage.
And I really feel like he may have checked into that play. Jarrett Brown may have checked into that play as a running play. Sometimes when they audibleize, they just switch the play was going right and switch it back to the left. But good, nice dance move there by Brown, picking up positive yards as they're looking at a second and three.
But you'll notice he didn't get too far away from Owen Schmidt. He pretty much followed him through that hole. Now he's going to run it again. Stutter step, spinning forward, flag down. I don't think he got the first down. Fitzhugh made the tackle on Jarrett Brown. He averages 33 yards a game rushing. He scored two rushing touchdowns. He has thrown for a touchdown. And let's see what the call is. We saw Capers, one of the interested parties. Now the referee is going to let us know what's going on. In a 31-13 game, we are past the midway point.
Clipping, number 66, offense.
Well, that's why Capers was taking a long look.
Second down.
Because the clip goes on him.
And Capers was pressed into starting service. He was a left tackle backup, moved to the right side as a starter for Figner.
Right.
And, you know, he was a converted tight end, was an outstanding basketball player. Speaking to Coach Huggins here, he's a three-year starter at St. Augustine High in New Orleans, one of the top programs around the country. And really an all-Louisiana tight end during his high school days.
It is second down and long yardage. They've got to get down to the six for a first down. And this snap will come from the 23. Out of the gun. Brown, pressured, gets away. Another stutter step move. He's at the 15. He's down to the 10-yard line. Dragged down by Fitzhugh, number one from behind.
On the quarterback.
A 12-yard pickup.
You know, Jarrett Brown learned the fundamentals from Adam Bednarik, but he learned how to read, throw, run, and read defenses from Patrick White. Does this look a little reminiscent of Patrick White? A bigger version, a 6'4", 220-pound version of Patrick White, and an outstanding basketball player. He is a well-rounded athlete.
Well, Bednarik, of course, a couple of years ago was the starter on this team, got hurt, and that ushered in the Pat White era, and it's tough to come back from that. But Bednarik is still on the team. They're out of the I formation. One wide receiver left, two to the right. Ball at the 10, third down and four. Close to the first down, but I do not think that he got there. Hughes was in defensively. Slayton carried the ball, but that yardage up the middle has been tough to come by, and it's going to be fourth and short.
And DeMario Bobo from his free safety position came in and really plugged hard and may have prevented him from getting much-needed first down territory, fourth and short. I think you're going for it, and you
well,
got.
You know the fans want them to go for it, that's for sure.
Tough call here by Rodriguez.
They're not coaching. Schmidt is in there as the fullback in front of Slayton. Two wideouts right, one left. Brown is under center. Let's see if they go to Slayton behind. No, they instead go to Schmidt straight ahead. That quick pop up the middle, and it's going to be close. I'm not sure he got there. They go that quick opener to Owen Schmidt, who scored a touchdown on a pass play earlier in the ball game. And I think he's going to be short.
It's close. Didn't make it.
They have had a lot of success on third and fourth down this season.
You know, he talked to Rich Rodriguez talked to us about the offensive line needs to get more physical up front. Now, credit the defensive line and linebackers from Mississippi State, but you know, they have not been as physical on short yardage situations. They don't face a lot of short yardage situations, but to shut down Owen Schmidt.
Well, now you put your pressure back on your defense because you've got them bottled up deep. Your defense has got to make a stop right here for West Virginia. Another drive that ends with no points. 31-13, though. The Mountaineers scored early and often and still have the lead. 4:22 remaining in the third quarter, and Sylvester Croom's team has won the battle since the first play of the second quarter. They have outscored West Virginia 13-0. We are here at Mountaineer Field at Milan Pushkar Stadium. Along with Rene Nadeau, I'm John Sanders. Dixon is the setback. And they play faked in. They've done a lot of that. Looking downfield, knocked away. Beautifully done by Ryan Monday. We talked about him at the start of the game and what he means to West Virginia. It was intended for Brandon McCray, but a nice recovery that time by Ryan Monday.
Skinny post, and boy, he just made a tremendous break on this ball, Ryan Monday. You see what he means to this defense and why he is said that he is one of the primary reasons the defense went from 62nd in 2006 to the number 5 rated unit in the nation this year. He left Michigan with some eligibility remaining and switched here, slipped through a loophole through the NCAA. That's been closed since.
Yeah, it has been closed. Dupree now is the tailback. They'll get it on a delay to Dupree. And he's going to be hit hard at the 15, maybe fall forward to the 16-yard line. And he'll be about a yard short of a first down. Langster made the hit on him, but Dupree, some positive yards out of the tailback spot. See, a little bit of a delay there.
And great play by Carroll and company as they really had everyone sucked in on pressure, expecting a pass, and Dupree comes up with the draw play. And nearly gets the first down, short by about a yard.
Dixon back in there at the running back position. He'll be the lone setback. McCray now goes to the left side. And they'll put in the extra tight end and go to Dixon. And he will weave his way close to the 20 for a first down. Ivy makes the tackle. But the positive push by Mississippi State continues. The true sophomore, what a year he had as a freshman. And as you pointed out, he leads the SEC in touchdowns now.
In high school, he out of Jackson, Mississippi, 2,683 yards as a senior, 31 touchdowns, almost 9 yards per carry. John, that's stout.
Back to the I formation with Hoskins in front of Dixon. Play fake, here comes the pressure. And from behind, it is Eric Wicks. The strong safety on the blitz, and Eric Wicks tracks him down from behind.
Oh, what a well-timed blitz is. Wicks came off, was exploded like out of a shot on the snap of the ball, and Dixon tried to pick him up on a blitz and just could not do it. Wicks is way too quick for that and gets his second sack of the season.
Well, we may see some more of that blitzing by this West Virginia defense, trying to slow down the Bulldogs, and they did that time as the ball is all the way back inside the 15 to about the 13-yard line. Third down and long yardage. Second down and 16. The extra tight end husband is in there. Anthony Dixon now, and maybe delay of game again. Yep.
Delay of game. Offense. 5-yard penalty. Still second down.
We'll back him up another 5. Make it second and 21. Ball will go back. Great. Right close to the 7-yard line. They've got to go to the 29 to get a first down. It's actually second and about 22.
West Virginia has some new people in. You saw Slavonic just now. A good size. 6'8", 268-pound defensive end.
Side handoff, bouncing out to about the 13-yard line is Dixon. Williams, Reed Williams, the leading tackler for the Mountaineers, number 47 there defensively. And it's going to be third and still long.
And the thing about Reed Williams is a father's son. He threw some bales of hay. He throws Dixon down pretty hard right here. You know, he's leading tackle, as you said. He had 8 stops. You know, earlier this season, he's just all over the field, plays from sideline to sideline. Great instincts for a middle linebacker.
Almagro moves down to a defensive end. Out of that slot linebacker's position. Time, pass, incomplete. Intended to Bell, and that was off target. Either Bell went inside, the ball went outside, and it was not close from Carroll. They will have to punt.
When they did a lone zone blitz that time with Magro on the edge, he looks like he's coming. He drops back, and they bring another rusher from another spot. And again, that is all confusing Carroll.
Well, they used 3 minutes and 9 seconds and went about 6 yards. There's the punt. Again, deep, it's Vaughn Rivers. Hit immediately, then gets away. Rivers looking for room, and they come back to get him at about the 48-yard line. 38-yard punt, 8-yard return. Marcus Washington made the tackle for State. So the Mounties will try it again. He got away from the initial hit. Bang, right there. It was Johnson that hit him first, and then he was tracked down from behind. But again, good field position for West Virginia. They'll have the ball at the 48 of the Bulldogs.
Anytime you have the ball on the opponents inside their 50, you're starting off on a positive as Carroll is exhorting his teammates and trying to get something going when they get the ball back.
Again, it's Jarrett Brown. Fake to Slayton. Dump it outside to Johnson. Tito will get nothing. This is the fifth time that West Virginia has started a possession in Mississippi State territory today.
And Tito, just trying to get that smoke route, just turns and faces the quarterback. He delivers the ball to him, and Mississippi State reacted very well to that, and for no gain, as Rich Rodriguez wonders what happened. They had such an easy going in the first quarter.
Well, you knew that was not going to continue at that level. We're in the final 30 seconds now of the third quarter. And West Virginia still trying to put something together. Slayton cuts it back. Spins down at the 45-yard line. Looked for a moment, Renee, like he might break it, but Kyle Love was not going to let him get away.
And he spun away and made the most out of that he could, but the pursuit caught up with him. And he just made a nice play, a nice run, nice individual effort. Good blocking there on the outside by Selfish Capers and company, and Slade just made the most of what he had opportunity for.
And time call, because that's the end of the third quarter. And they love every place. The home team loves the fourth quarter. They think they own it. Well, West Virginia owned the first quarter, but it's been Mississippi State in control since. 31-13. We have played three in Morgantown. Back with the final 15 after this. On the first play of the second quarter. It's been all Bulldogs for their head coach Sylvester Croom since. Let's see what the Mountaineers can do here as they face a third and fairly long. It's third and six. They empty the backfield. They've got five wide receivers in this formation. Brown sets, looks, runs away from pressure, steps up. Now he's got some room up the middle. First down. And Moise goes outside. Hughes ran him out. But that's the versatility of the size. He picks up 13. He gets a first.
The Fort Lauderdale 6'8 player of the year in high school. 7,100 yards, 73 touchdowns. Boy, I tell you, if he didn't look like Vince Young in that last run, he's got a tremendous future. Just a sophomore.
And in case you're wondering, the one name that we have not mentioned this afternoon, because he hasn't been in for one snap, is the freshman Noel Devine. The highly touted freshman who was getting a lot of playing time, but not today. Look out from behind. Slayton is dragged down by Douglas. That's what you talked about, the second half, and now the fourth quarter for Slayton. As he's got to, along with his offensive line, take charge of this game. Get the Mountaineers back on the positive side offensively. There's a good hole there.
Tremendous hole on the right side, and good read with his vision. Rotomoya and Capers open a gaping hole for him on the right-hand side, and he just shoots through it, explodes, running downhill, and if it were not been for that tackle, we'd be kicking the extra point.
18 carries, 100 yards on the nose for Slayton. They go outside to Raynaud, and it's incomplete. Darius Raynaud was there. The pass was too tall. Last year against Mississippi State, Slayton had 185 yards, and he's averaging almost a little over 104 yards a game coming into today, and he's right at 100 this afternoon as it's second down and 10.
Slayton, fourth in the Heisman balloting last year, and holds the Sugar Bowl record with 204 yards. 100, it's every time he touched the ball. Three touchdowns, 204 yards rushing in the Sugar Bowl.
Backs are split now. Out of the gun, it's Brown. Looking toward the end zone, too tall and too far out in front. Darrell Jolla was the intended receiver, number 21, the junior from Greensboro, North Carolina, but he couldn't get to that one. It was a little too much in front. Coverage from Washington on the play, and now it's third and 10 for Brown.
And Marcus Washington in pretty good coverage here. Boy, he just, good break on the inside, and that's about the best you can play that when you have a slant, a tough pattern to cover as a cornerback.
Brown, rolling right, looks, throws to the end zone, touchdown! Second one for Raynard this afternoon, and the Mountaineers end the drought. Took good time that time, Renee, to let his pattern develop for his receivers.
That's a mark of maturity. Good play action fake. Slayton sucks the linebackers in, and he just takes his time, delivers the ball, and throws his second touchdown toss of the season. And Raynard had put a little separation between him and the defensive back, and Raynard just continues to excel. And boy, he's got tremendous explosion between Raynard, Slayton, and White. That's the fastest trio in the country.
And the extra point attempt is good. So it's 38-13. Mountaineers offense wakes up as the fourth quarter begins. So West Virginia reestablishes the big lead. It's 38-13 over Mississippi State. After being shut down for almost just short, 6 seconds short of a full 30 minutes, the West Virginia offense comes alive and they go up 38-13. We are in the fourth quarter. They scored in the first 6 seconds on the field goal in the first play of the second half. But since then, Renee, until that drive, nothing.
Well, you know, they have caught fire, and Jarrett Brown has gained some confidence, and they're back where they want to be, and Rich Rodriguez has to be a little happy with that last drive.
Short kick goes to Stallworth, and he is banged as it gets to about the 34-yard line, dropped on the play. So West Virginia's special teams. Andy Emery makes the tackle. We'll see what the Dogs can do. They came out with the first possession of the second half and marched it down the field. But at this point, they have, I think, pretty much stuck to their game plan. And they're not playing with an extreme sense of urgency so far in the second half.
Well, you know, again, the bread and butter, they're not really a great passing team. The running is their game, and they have to establish the run. They really haven't done it as much as they need to really get West Virginia defense sold on that.
And they're out of the shotgun now. Passing formation, the pass is knocked in the air and it's incomplete. Lewis was right there. Co-Eric Riley was the intended receiver. But Lewis got to it.
Lewis from Waldorf, Maryland. Good break on the ball here. He just stuck that left hand, that free hand up, and just knocked it away. And good job.
Barry has checked as going out for West Virginia. That's five straight incompletions now for Wesley Carroll, who used the pass play to help him get back into them in the third quarter. Tailback is Stallworth. Dump it off. The pass is caught on about the 36-yard line. Stallworth goes down in the arms of Lewis. So a short gain.
Lewis 110%. It comes up and feels pretty good from his right cornerback position. He feels real well and reacts to the ball and made a nice stop. And you see Carroll dropping back. And Lewis was right there in the vicinity, and he comes up real quick. And boy, I tell you, he don't go for any moves. He just goes for the legs. A nice tackle.
And once again, Magro will move up into a blitzing situation, more of a down lineman than a linebacker in this third and about eight. Flags. Wesley runs away and throws it away. He throws it short. Wicks was the pressure that time once again. Tony Burks was the intended receiver, but that was not going to happen. We'll see what the flag is.
Might be going against the Mountaineers. Not sure. Looks like somebody moved. Or may have been drawn off.
Offsides. Number 92. Defense.
There you go. That was Dingle. A little anxious to get in there, and it's a 5-yard penalty that shortens the distance for the first down on the third down play. Mark Curlis has been our referee. We saw the linesman, Alama Matthews in there as well. And Dingle, he's had the good and the bad of it, I guess, today, huh?
He's got a great first step. He leads the Big East in forced fumbles, and he has played sideline to sideline. This has been probably his best effort yet.
Third down and three. Again, they stay with the gun. Motion man is long. Wesley looks over the middle, throws. It is caught, and it's going to be a first down. I'm not sure the receiver even expected it, but Husband turned around, and the ball hit him right in the gut, right in front of Ryan Monday. So Husband has played pretty big. Holmes was there as well defensively, but it is going to be a Bulldog first down.
And Johnny Williams also stuck a big pop there, and Johnny Holmes, I should say, and could knock it away. And
yep.
Good coverage, but nice completion, and nice throw and catch by Carroll.
We've seen a lot of Carroll out of the shotgun here in the second half. Go with a lone setback here. Husband is in motion. Stallworth is the tailback. He blocks. Wesley runs away, throws back across his body, and it was almost caught by Riley. Lewis there defensively for the Mountaineers, but I tell you what, it's like Carroll's confidence has gone up. Even though he's not completing in a high percentage, he's throwing with more confidence.
That's a gutsy and dangerous throw, throwing across his body. Look, this is very tough, throwing across the grain in that tight window of opportunity. I'm sure he'll be addressed. Don't try that again. You have more opportunity for an interception and a completion.
Second down, 10. The ball at the 46-yard line. Still on the state side of the field. The Mounties lining up defensively, trying to bring some pressure. Showing blitz. They don't come. Short pass is caught right at midfield. That's Burks who made the catch. It was wrapped up quickly. They were getting some pressure that time from Morty Ivy, was coming from that wide linebacker spot, but he couldn't get there in time. It's just inside the 50, and it'll be third down.
Burks just ran that short cross right across, right in front of the linebackers, and he made the catch. But that's more of a throw that hopefully after the completion, the receiver can make something happen. But they reacted so quickly, it didn't give any running room. It's now third and five.
Dixon back in there as the running back. Carroll out of the shotgun. Three wide receivers in this formation. They look to Dixon, first down. Dixon at the 35-yard line, dropped from behind. But he got into that secondary in a hurry. Monday is there defensively. It's a 16-yard gain for Mississippi State. Good play.
Dixon doesn't catch the ball often, came into this game with just three grabs, but right in the middle where you least suspect him to be, and he just sneaks into that open cavity and burns West Virginia. Boy, I tell you, he can do it all, catch and throw, and catch and run and block.
Dixon stays in there. Hoskins checks back in as the fullback out of the I formation. Two wide receivers, one right, one left. Under center, there's the pitch and the reverse. No, sir. Not going to get away. That was long on the reverse, but the veteran Wicks was all over it. Number 41, Eric Wicks.
Boy, what a playmaker. He's really does a great job. He's a big-time hitter and intimidator, 6'1", 205. And boy, he just smelled this coming, got into the backfield, great penetration.
And he wasn't going to let go.
And he waited till the cavalry arrived. You know, he plays that strong safety position, which is kind of like a spur position, which is be a strong safety outside linebacker monster. So he has so many responsibilities and duties, and he does so well, got a nose for the ball, great in coverage. He's the total package, a senior from Pittsburgh.
Butler moves into the backfield. Out of the gun on second and 22. Carroll throws, almost intercepted. Boogie Allen got a hand on it, but could not hang on. It was high and uncatchable by either. The ball will stay back at the 47, and it'll be third down and 22.
Boogie Allen almost came up with his second interception of his career.
He
had one last year and didn't have any, but he had a good opportunity. Good look at Johnny Holmes.
But once again, the throw by Carroll was really too tall for anybody.
Yeah, and they're not giving him any, you know, they're dropping five now, and they're not giving any passing lanes. And really, West Virginia defensive backfield, John, reacts so well to the ball, and it's tough. They don't give you much time to complete.
Bell and Burks to this side. Stallworth is the lone running back. And now time is called. It's a third delay of game call we've had.
Yes.
And this is the eighth game of the season. That will drive a head coach nuts.
know there are a couple of positive. Coach Kroom and his staff will come out of this, but you know, the penalties have really, really hurt this team.
Well, I got to give them credit. And they're blitzed 6 seconds into the second quarter, 31-0.
Yeah.
And they put their helmets back on and went out, and as you said, they got up and battled. Third down, 27. Bell and Burks to this side. They dump it off, and the catch is made. Loose football. Still loose. Mountaineers have it. Holmes is on it. Stallworth caught the ball and was looking at positive yardage. They were going to be a long way from the first down, but then he coughs it up, so that's the third fumble by Mississippi State.
And that is Mississippi State is really, in able four plays like this, he has an entourage in front of him. Nice block there. And all of a sudden he sees
from behind.
He gets stripped from behind.
It looked like Pugh got it. Charles Pugh got an arm in there, knocked the ball loose, and after it kicked around for a while, there's the reach in by Pugh that knocked it loose.
Two or three Mountaineers had opportunity, and one Mississippi State player had a chance, and finally, jumping on a loose pigskin is the Mountaineers.
I thought the Bulldogs were going to get that one back. Coming outside is Slayton. He's got a first down inside the 40-yard line. And Steve Slayton beginning to churn those legs and come on. He picks up 20 more there. Johnson made the tackle. It'll be a first down, West Virginia.
You know, he's a home run back, and we talked about he's done this well. He's attacked the defense now, and you know, you don't know, he doesn't waste any steps. He doesn't run east and west. He runs north and south, and you know, he's it's funny that, you know, as the game goes on, he feels more confident and he feels stronger and gets more yards.
Well, he's got 120 yards. Schmidt is with him in the backfield. Jared Brown has been the quarterback the entire second half. Slayton, not too much that time as he gets down to about the 36-yard line. Brown, Titus Brown, and Bobo were there defensively for the Bulldogs. He'll pick up a few more yards. Pick up a couple, so he's now at 122. Remember, he had 185 last year against Mississippi State. But also, that was a game, I mentioned it a couple times, where they scored, the Mountaineers scored 21 points
right
in the fourth quarter.
And he had a lot to do with that.
Patrick White played only the first half this afternoon and played well. From 64 yards, first time he touched the ball. Slayton for another yard, and that's about it. Damon Blanton is there defensively. Slayton has helped up. And now the Mountaineers beginning to work that clock a little bit.
You know, Slayton was, we've told us earlier before, was recruited by Maryland as defensive back. Ralph Regan wanted to see him on defense, so he played in one of his biggest games against Maryland last year. 195 yards, 149 coming in one quarter.
Now there you see the numbers. 123 today. Now Brown hesitates. He's changing the play. Another 100-yard rushing game for Steve Slayton. Brown will throw. Caught. No. Incomplete. Intended for Wes Lyons. Now, Wes Lyons is a big kid who's had all kinds of physical problems. Had his knee scoped before the season. He is 6'8", 220. And you think when you get in the red zone, this is a kid that you could go to.
Kind of a Harold Carmichael, if you will, and got that height, basketball height, and Jared Brown steps into his throw here.
Yeah, it was knocked down, though. Didn't that defender, I think,
yeah,
the linebacker
exactly.
Got a piece
got
of
a it. Hand on it, so it wasn't changed. It dripped a little bit.
It might have been Hughes who got a piece of that. Now Schmidt is in the backfield. Quick kick, that's what he's done before. I remember the first time I saw them practicing, and I was anxious to see Schmidt move all over the field, and all of a sudden he lined up and dropped a quick kick on him. But that's the second time he's done that this season.
What a great, great athlete.
It is a 25-yard quick kick. It'll push the Bulldogs back to their own 10. We'll be back. And that is a cell phone tower. We're getting to jump on Christmas with a Christmas tree look, I think. Here are the All-State BCS standings. Ohio State in front in their game today. West Virginia beginning in the number 9 spot. South Florida will not be number 2 next week.
And, you know, there'll be some movement as there always is week in and week out. You know, when you're in a catbird seat, that's the worst place to be, it seems like.
It does. There's a little draw play up the middle. Ducree carries, and he'll get about 3, maybe 4 on the play. Take a look at the rest of the standings as far as the BCS is concerned, our all-state standings review. Kansas is there. There's some teams there, Renee, that you would never have thought, you know?
You know, we talk about Kansas is certainly a team that is surprised some people. They're one of the 3 schools that rated in the top 16. Cincinnati is a team that surprised many. Texas Tech, they can score on anybody.
Carroll sets, throws, got it. It was complete to Burks. Williams is right there with him, and they're going to be short of the first down. So it'll be 3rd down coming up for the Bulldogs, who have played the Mountaineers even since the start of the second quarter.
Reed Williams, this is a junior. Boy, I tell you what, he's done a good job from his middle linebacker position, and 7th in the Big East in tackles, 8 per game. Move from the outside to the inside to spring and did a good job.
Well, no quit in this Mississippi State team and that freshman quarterback, though.
They got it all. Very good.
They played tough. Again, it's Ducree, the lone setback. Out of the shotgun. Ducree is a blocker. Carroll's throw. Bobbled an incomplete. Intended again for Tony Burks. So Burks could not hang on. It will be 4th down and 4.
Carroll is going to his favorite receiver, Tony Burks, and this time went successful. Didn't know if he even made the first down, had he made the catch, but had some running room and a couple of defensive players between he and the first down marker.
Vaughn Rivers will be deep for West Virginia to receive the punt of Blake McAdam. Very wobbly kick. Almost looked like they might have gotten a piece of it. He gets a good bounce, and Rivers runs away from it, so it works out all right for the Bulldogs because it's inside the 45 for the 45, and it turns out to be a 40-yard punt for the 44-yard line where the Mountaineers will put it in play. But we're going to take a break. With 7:04 remaining, we're past the midway point in the fourth quarter. The Mountaineers are still in control, 38-13. Well, mistakes have been a big part of it for the Bulldogs. They have turned it over. This is Dixon. It kicks loose, and it winds up in the hands of Magro, who brings it back 35 yards, sets up a score.
It's the first of 3 fumbles. This is the Morty Ivy. Would have been a touchdown had it not been from the block in the back
right there.
And this is the 3rd miscue that is scooped up by a Mountaineer. 3 fumbles has really, really hurt these Bulldogs.
And some costly penalties at the wrong time have also hurt Slayton. Dragged down as he gets to the 48 by Derek Pegues, number 3. Pegues has played a lot this afternoon. He's in on defense and runs back to all the kicks and the kickoffs. And Slayton continues to add to his total. He'll pick up 4 more, and that puts him at 127. He's carried the ball 22 times, and his number of carries had been down the last couple of weeks, but it has changed this afternoon as he is still in there behind the big fullback, and he'll take the pitch and try to get outside. Not much. Hughes and Fitzhugh were there defensively, and they wrap up Slayton. No gain, might have even lost a yard. We'll see.
And Bailey, that's a good story right there, John. We talked about him. He is a guy from Glen Allen, Mississippi, and he was deployed in Iraq for 18 months. Boy, he is one tough hombre, and 6'3", 241-pound junior. Was away from football for 2 years, and boy, I tell you what, he's that battle he's been in. Is
absolutely.
This is
probably mild to him, huh?
Oh, wow.
Ready for a little hand-to-hand combat. It's 3rd down and 6. Brown, nothing. Hughes, from his middle linebacker spot, was there to make the tackle. Bailey deployed with the Mississippi unit into Iraq. Just tough to go away from football, especially be in that situation, and come back and start playing again.
Exactly right. But, you know, he inspires and motivates his teammates because after what he's been through, you know, the normal everyday kind of challenges seem very minor.
McAfee will punt. Fair catch called for by Long, and he'll run away from it. We do have a flag down on the far side of the field. We'll see what that's about, because the kick for West Virginia works out well. It's inside the five, a 47-yard punt by McAfee, who's kicked the ball very well. He has a field goal this afternoon. He's been successful on all of his point afters. And I have still not seen an indication from our referee. We're going to make him kick it again.
Illegal formation. Number 29, kicking team, was not on the line of scrimmage. Only 6 men on the line of scrimmage.
Now, that's what we talked about earlier. You've got to have everybody on the line, even if you're punting the ball. And he may take a step back to get, you know, a jump to get down and cover the punt, but they're going to make him kick it over.
You know, Mississippi State has struggled with this spread option, and like we said a couple of times already, they don't see this in the SEC very often. You know, this defense is spread option, rather. It sucks you up defensively. It makes you play their type of game. It's a monster. And once they get things going, it's run by a Patrick White, a very smart guy, and if you have a guy who runs that machine expertly, it is very, very tough to defend, John. And Mississippi State is at a tough time.
So again, it's Long and Pegues deep to receive the kick of McAfee, who has a 47-yarder wiped out that would have buried them deep in their own territory. So we'll see what happens with this one. A little bit more pressure, but not much. He'll kick away from Pegues, who's going to let it go out of bounds. And we'll have to see where the referee or the official spots it. Come out beyond the 20 to about the 22-yard line. It'll be first down and 10 for the Bulldogs of Mississippi State. Starkville, Mississippi, 36-yard punt. No return because it went out of bounds. And here comes the freshman again, Wesley Carroll.
Mississippi State faithful here and stayed to the very end. Wesley Carroll, a freshman from St. Thomas Aquinas in Palmdale, Florida, taking every snap and gained some very valuable experience and seen some good things.
Still hasn't thrown that interception. He is 14 of 28 for 135 yards. Dupree is the running back alongside. Carroll fires far side, caught at the 22, and immediately Husband, the tight end who's been in on a lot of reception and reception attempts. Rivers was there defensively. Rivers, the backup cornerback behind Williams.
As a return specialist, now comes in from defense, and he's on the got the outside responsibility, comes in and makes a stop on a Husband and for a short gain.
A couple of yards on the play. It's second down and 8. Clock winding. 4:16 left in the game. An explosive start. The Mountaineers scored the first time they had the ball 5 straight times and had a 31-0 lead. Then they kind of quieted down. Carroll out of the gun, under pressure, runs away, throws, and is caught. It was deflected and caught by Burks. Williams was there with him, but it was tipped in the air, and he was able to recover and pick up 13 yards.
Nice catch by Burks, and it was tipped, as you said, by Larry Williams, the cornerback, and Herman Carroll just flushed out of the pocket, throws on the run, and that was just nice concentration on the out route.
That was Langster who deflected the pass. And coming in to make the tackle on the play was Reed Williams. But Langster got a hand on it. It's a first down. Out at the 35-yard line. 3:45 to play. We're in the fourth. West Virginia has led from their first offensive play of the game. And the snap was short, but it's picked up. And again, it's number 4. A flag down in the backfield. I'm not sure if it's going to be on West Virginia. Ivy there on the coverage, but Tony Burks was able to pick up some good yards. He'll get about 7 on the play. But we did have the flag in the backfield. I'm not sure if it's roughing the passer or what.
Dingle is right in his face, and it may be
personal
it.
Foul. Roughing the passer, number 92.
You're right.
Defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
Well, it's been a good news, bad news day, I guess, for Johnny Dingle. He's done some great things, and he's also he tried to hold him up a little bit, but he got there too late.
Well, the thing is, you know, that's the 5th or 6th penalty assessed against the Mountaineers, and that's not a good thing. Rich Rodriguez coming into this game averaged 3.6 penalties per. So regardless of the score, that's something is certainly going to concern him.
Well, the ball moves all the way inside the 45 to the 43. Again, it's Ducree. We have not seen much of Dixon lately. Maybe he's pooped out a little bit. Carroll runs away from pressure, steps out of a tackle, and goes out of bounds. It was Cooper with some pressure.
pocket, not quite finish him off, but he's still going to lose yardage on the play. Back outside the 45 to near the 48-yard line. Cooper with some good pressure. Cooper a backup to Morty Ivey. Some of the second-team players getting some playing time.
You know, the thing we talked about last time we were here, John, is that Rich Rodriguez does such an outstanding job with walk-ons. 26 scholarships have been awarded to walk-ons the last 5 years, and being a walk-on himself, he certainly can understand, and that certainly is, you know, rewards for Gaffer.
They'll get back past the original line of scrimmage before he's being chased back by Wicks. We talked a lot about it. And that pass was complete to Ducree out of the backfield, but it has been a season of upsets. And if you were ranked in the top 10 preseason, everybody there has lost the game.
Yeah. And every week, I mean, again, you know, USF, Tennessee, South Carolina, Cincinnati, just teams keep tumbling and falling, and you know, the beat goes on. It's going to be tough to stay in that top two or three at season's end.
Arnell Stallworth is now the running back, and it's been strictly passing by Carroll of late. Goes deep down the middle, and that one's knocked away. Read beautifully downfield defensively. Coming up was Ryan Monday, and he could see that play coming. He made his break. He got there and broke it up.
Runs right up the seam in front of Monday, and you can see him.
Here he comes.
Right in front of the goal post, running a skinny post, and Monday makes the break on that. And again, he's seen it all. He's been at Michigan and played in the Rose Bowl and so many starts, and, you know, he brings that leadership, and he recognizes very, very quickly what the offense is trying to do.
It is fourth down and seven. Pass was intended for Tony Burks, who has stepped up in this second half. Burks will go wide right along with Bell. Husband Stallworth in the backfield. And again, Carroll goes out of the shotgun, dodges one tackle, throws the ball downfield, and knocked away. That was Lancaster who batted the ball away, but Ivy applied the pressure that time, could not get to him to finish the job for the sack, but the Mountaineers will get the ball with 2:20 to play.
Boogie Allen had an interception, his name all over it. If it's not swatted away, Boogie Allen would have had that interception as knocks away right here, but number 20 looked right in your screen, had an interception, ready for it, and
not to be.
Not to be.
So the Mountaineers will try to run off some time here. Now timeout is called. I don't think that's the Mountaineers' first timeout in this game tonight. First timeout in the second half, we know. It's a 30-second timeout, still 2:20 on the clock. The Rich Rodriguez Club is going to win this football game, and they will go to 6-1. And they're 1-1 in conference play, and they've got a big test coming up next weekend in Piscataway.
Wow.
And Bednarik, I think, is going to be the quarterback now. A guy that was the starter a few years ago. Adam Bednarik. He can also play a little wide receiver. He's out of Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, 6'2", 225-pound senior.
Got some pretty good bloodlines with Chuck Bednarik.
Absolutely.
But he's like a coach on the field, and you know, when he's in there, you know, he's got the respect of his teammates, and we talked about how he's been such a big help to Jared Brown and Pat White.
And Jock Sanders now is the running back. Moving in there as Bednarik will take the shotgun snap. That's Jock Sanders trying to get outside, another one of their highly recruited freshmen. Clock winding down to 2 minutes left, and we're going to update the Big East standings. You see that UConn is right now the only team in the conference undefeated in conference play. Rutgers winning their second with that big win at home against South Florida. Bulls are 1-1. Mountaineers are 1-1. And of course, this is a non-conference game. They're going to go to 6-1 overall. Now, everybody's won a game, and only UConn has not lost so far. That's not the way the standings expected to look as we head to the middle part of the season.
I like this guy, Donald Brown, the running back from UConn. It's very impressive.
Well, they've done a great job up there. They made the decision a few years back to go to Division I. Sanders trying to get outside. Won't do it. He'll be wrestled down inside the 40 at the 38 by Fitzhugh. Jock Sanders at the tailback. He's 5'8", 185. Freshman from St. Petersburg, Florida. And the guy we've talked about who hasn't played at all, Noel Devine, is from North Fort Myers, Florida. He's 5'8", 170. So they were aware of each other when they were in high school. But I think everybody was aware of Noel Devine.
Well, they push each other quite a bit, too. And they're heir apparent to Steve Slate. Good look right there at Noel Devine, and they call him Skittles. Skittles Devine, and boy, I tell you, he's a wrapped up ball of energy. 6,800 yards, 92 touchdowns.
Well, he was a star on YouTube, wasn't he?
Wow.
Is right. Third down, long. We're in the final minute. Bednarik taking his time. Use all the clock he can. Quarterback draw. Bednarik, they try to track him down. He gets outside the 40 and is wrestled down by Hughes. So Bednarik will pick up some positive yards, but it'll be fourth down for the West Virginia Mountaineers, and we still have about 25 seconds to go. That's going to do it. And the Mountaineers, Coach Rich Rodriguez, will start the victory walk across Mountaineer Field at Milan Puskar Stadium. And West Virginia, for the second year in a row, have defeated Croom's Bulldogs in last year's game.
That's the end of the game.
That is the end of the game. They won in Starksville. Won 42-14. Today it is 38-13, so pretty similar score, but a different style, because last year they scored 21 points in the fourth quarter. Today they scored 28 points in the first quarter and pretty much put it out of reach. So we will hopefully get Rich to give us a word. Croom and the Bulldogs will head back to Mississippi and get ready for their next meeting against Kentucky. And there's some more work to be done next week for the Mountaineers, obviously, Renee, because they've got to go to Rutgers and Piscataway.
That's going to be a tough, tough game. And, boy, after what Rutgers did the other night and knocked off second-ranked South Florida, you got to score reverse there, Mississippi State with 13. You know, you got to think that that's wishful thinking, I would hope.
It looks closer that way, doesn't it?
It does look better. But, you know, South Florida, and it's going to be tough. Rutgers, again, whoever wins, it seems like whoever wins at the top has the disadvantage. You know, it just motivates the opponent that much more to knock you off, and it's tougher to stay up there. You know, South Florida's got a good team, but, you know, not having been there before, prior, it's tough to hold and maintain that position when it's foreign territory to you, if you will.
Well, if you're Mississippi State, then the opposition scores on five straight possessions, and you look up and you've hardly taken a breath, and it's 31-0. That's a shock, and they did battle back and play well after that. But the victory goes to the Mountaineers of West Virginia, 38-13, and Patrick White played only the first half. He exploded for a long touchdown run of 64 yards, first time he touched the ball.
And I think it dispelled any rumors that he's injured and he won't be back. And credit Jared Brown coming in. And Steve Slayton, only 123 yards the last couple of weeks, no touchdowns. He came back strong.
He did come back strong. They win it by 25, 38-13 is the score. And they are having a little Rocky Mountain, West Virginia Mountain High here in West Virginia, because they've won their sixth game of the season. They win it fairly easily, although they kind of drifted off a little bit after that big lead. But it's tough to play when you score five straight possessions. You know?
It really is. And, you know, the thing is that's why the coach, a win or lose, he has to make sure that team stays focused. It's nothing to nothing, and make sure you approach it that way and come back. And, you know, I think West Virginia just found themselves in the lead and with all these gifts they were given, all the fumbles and stuff.
Fumbles, three of them.
And they were just giving away some, you know, you take it, you give it, we take it. And West Virginia took advantage.
Well, penalties, too, at the wrong time. Some key situations, including the opening kickoff of the football game, when it looked like they had a fumble recovery themselves.
And that was a key play, John, because had Mississippi State gotten that, momentum might have shifted a little bit. It might have been a whole different setup for Mississippi State.
There is Schmidt. And a little bit of everything from him again today, including a quick kick. And remember, he's one of those walk-ons. He played at a small school up north and then came here. And we are joined downstairs by Steve Slayton. Steve, congratulations. Another terrific job. This is the second year in a row that you've had a very big game against Mississippi State. Congratulations.
Thank you. I appreciate it very much.
You had not been carrying quite as much in the past couple of weeks until today, but that changed. Was that by design? Did you know you were going to carry the ball more today?
Yeah, coach told me to be prepared to carry more load today because, I mean,
you had a week off and just get everything rolling again.
Steve, talk a little bit about your offensive line. They opened some gaping holes that you took advantage of today.
I mean, they did well. I mean, they came out prepared. We had their 2 weeks off, and they did a good job today.
Well, I know Pat didn't play in the second half. Is he all right? As far as we know, they just decided to go Jarek in the second half?
He's doing well. I mean, no injuries. It was just precaution. He didn't want to get him hurt again.
How are you physically at this point in the season after the week off?
I feel great. I feel like we just started again.
Steve, was it tough with so many points in the first half? You guys had a dominating lead. It's kind of tough to stay focused when you have such a big lead over an opponent.
Yeah, it is. I think we strayed a little bit, but we pulled off with the win, so that's always important.
Yeah, man, you know it's not going to be easy next week. You got to go to Rutgers.
Yeah, it's not going to be easy. They just defeated South Florida, and it's going to be a big game.
Well, thanks, Steve, very much. Another good ball game. Congratulations and good luck.
Thank you. No problem.
Steve Slayton, another big afternoon. The Mountaineers roll 38-13. We are not finished. Stay with us. We'll be back to Morgantown after this.